fourth day of August 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We're going to be live here for the next 4 hours. Another very important broadcast transmission straight ahead. Trump came to town last night. A lot of news on that front. More leaks, more emails. Chelsea Clinton is in deep trouble. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to break it all down. But first, George Soros is in the Jerusalem Post being called a megalomaniac, so I thought we would air this special report.
Yet another American community is descended on by violent ignorance masquerading as a civil rights protest after a black career criminal was taken out by a black police officer after dangerously brandishing a stolen firearm. So where are the leaders of the supposed righteous anger boiling over in Milwaukee? Typically, President Barack Obama fiddled on the golf course while Rome burned. Obama's deputy press secretary, Jen Friedman, provided a statement that read, "The president is golfing at Farm Neck Golf Club, one of his favorite courses on Martha's Vineyard." Also today, the administration said the president had been updated on the situation in Milwaukee. Meanwhile, Obama protege and Soros-insulated leader of Black Lives Matter, DeRay McKesson, tweeted, "I denounce the state violence that led to any protests in the first place." Is this statement a result of McKesson's shallow incomprehension in the face of total anarchy based on the real facts? Or is there another hand at play here, directing Obama's incompetence and McKesson's callowness? It should come as no surprise that Black Lives Matter leader DeRay McKesson lives in a home owned by philanthropists James and Robin Wood in Baltimore, Maryland. The American Mirror reports it's the same address he used when declaring his residency on his campaign committee registration form for his failed mayoral run in the city's Democratic primary earlier this year. The Woods have owned the home since 1996 and are wealthy donors to the Baltimore chapter of George Soros's Open Society Institute. Robin is so active that she was made a board member of the far-left nonprofit back in 2008, according to the OSI's website. Anarchy organizer McKesson essentially resides in a clear example of the supposed white suburbs that the deranged mob in Milwaukee is threatening to burn down. And while the pawns of George Soros do their part to subtly fan the flames of division amongst the brainwashed citizenry of the United States, led by a wave of the Chicago chapter of the Revolutionary Communist Party, now being largely blamed for the escalation in Milwaukee, George Soros and sons continue to build a Trojan horse of jihadist migration-embedded refugees aimed squarely at nothing less than unleashing a total disintegration of Western civilization. The Daily Caller reports a leaked memo from left-wing financier George Soros's Open Society Foundations argues that Europe's refugee crisis should be accepted as a new normal, and that the refugee crisis means new opportunities for Soros's organization to influence immigration policies on a global scale. A section of the review titled Our Work describes how America's least transparent think tank has worked with leaders in the field to shape migration policymaking and influence regional and global processes affecting the way migration is governed and enforced. In a section titled Our Ambitions, the authors explain, "Our premise for engaging in work related to governance was that, in addition to mitigating the negative effects of enforcement, we should also be supporting actors in the field proactively seeking to change the policies, rules, and regulations that govern migration. Anarchy at our doorstep, fueled by foreign interests, lingering hubris in the White House, and a treasonous, power-hungry menace is one step away from being the next commander-in-chief. Time to wake up, America, before you wake up homeless on the continent your fathers conquered."
You still don't get it, do you, boys? There ain't no countries anymore. No more good guys. They're running the whole show. They own everything, the whole damn planet. They can do whatever they want. What's wrong with having it good for a change? Now, they're going to let us have it good if we just help them. They're going to leave us alone. Let us make some money. You can have a little taste of that good life, too.
John Bell for Infowars.com.
Every day I open the show up with the unoriginal statement that this is going to be an amazing broadcast. There is so much information. But we live on an incredible planet. We live in a civilization just filled with wonderment, magic, so many great things, so many awesome things, also so many horrible things. But we are in a universe of wonder. And everything the global social engineer architects push is about shuttering perception and then only giving you a tiny pinhole view of the universe that they control, thus playing God. They're not God, so they create a little false universe that they can rule. They are the Lillipullies of the Lillipullies. Or what did they call those in that story about the Lilliputians that tie down the bigger fellow that visits their island? That's where we are today. And the moment we realize that is the moment their empire of control begins to collapse. I think it was Gulliver's Travels. Where to start? Let me just try to just mention some of the news we have here in front of us. I'm obviously really in a great mood. In so-called liberal Austin, fake liberal Austin, brainwashed Austin, pseudo-intellectual Austin, we witnessed 100-to-1 patriots versus Trump haters that were out there putting out their propaganda and disinformation. We've got the video of that. A lot of my crew had to park their cars miles away and walk into the Travis County Expo Center yesterday, where Trump spoke to tens of thousands of people. He also spoke to a capacity crowd at the Moody Theater, in between going to several fundraisers, even though he'd already conducted fundraisers in Fort Worth that same day. Talk about stamina versus Hillary, who comes out and gives a 10-minute speech and then, like a moray eel, goes back into the dark. We point that out and they say, we're sexist. Oh, how intellectual. We're so threatened by a woman being president. That's why we don't like her. No, she gave all the missile secrets to the communist Chinese for their Long March ICBM and about 100 other plus crimes that are on record. That's why we don't like her. Same reason I didn't like George W. Bush. Same reason we don't like Bill Clinton or Barack Obama. But I will tell you, with the Clintons, because they've been around so long, they're about the worst people I've ever seen in history. When you just talk about the longevity, the stamina to commit crime, and then even as walking dead zombies, still struggling towards more power, more billions. Because believe me, if you think they're only worth a couple hundred million, I've got a bridge I want to sell you on another planet. The Clintons have set up foundations all over the world. Everything they do is basically secret. And now real liberals like Julian Assange and others start leaking the information of what these master criminals are doing. And it's exactly what we knew they were doing. Foreign leaders, dictators, corporations, in some cases giving them tens of millions of dollars. And then they go in the State Department and get the concessions with foreign governments to give those groups monopolies over uranium, oil, rare earth minerals, slave labor. The TPP legalizes slavery. It actually allows it. I mean, these people are monstrous criminals. And they're allied with the Republican criminals at the top who are all waging war against Donald Trump. Only a crazy person would not gamble on Trump. And by gamble, he's an unknown country in many respects. I think he's a good guy overall, but nobody's perfect. But it's no gamble at all. It's a sure lose with what we currently have. And that's what Hillary is. The establishment incarnate, manifested before our very eyes. And if we don't fully reject her and Goldman Sachs and the communist Chinese and her biggest backer, Carlos Slim, the Mexican kingpin, talk about Lord of the Flies. This guy is El Jefe. He's what all the other kingpins wish they were. And we sit here as a captured nation, divided up, kind of like China was a few hundred years ago by the Allied powers. That's really what globalism is, but it's corporations dividing up countries, not countries dividing up countries. It is slavery. And that perception, that two-party, or in Europe, three-, four-party illusion, where they're all basically in cahoots together at the top, is being shattered by populists like Nigel Farage in the UK and like Donald Trump here in the United States. So regardless of whether Donald Trump's perfect or not, or Nigel Farage is perfect or not, or if Alex Jones is perfect or not, it is a sign of populism growing. A tremor before the larger quakes that you can bet are imminent. And the seismic shift is humanity awakening. A lot of folks ask me why I didn't go to the Moody event, which I was obviously invited to, or to the bigger event in North Austin that was open to the public. And I said InfoWars was there. We sent a bunch of our great reporters. They did an amazing job. But InfoWars was there in the thousands of Hillary for Prison shirts and InfoWars shirts. You are InfoWars, not Alex Jones. See, if Alex Jones doesn't go to something, it doesn't matter because you're there. You are InfoWars. And people need to figure that out. Getting Donald Trump on the show, which is going to come on soon, I haven't really pushed for it, isn't what it's all about. It's about changing the narrative back towards Renaissance, common sense, and reality. And it's about seeing Donald Trump carry the banner of liberty. That's the success. Not going to some dinner and you know, sitting around eating steaks and being patted on the head. If Donald Trump gets elected, I really don't think I'm going to go to the White House. I don't think I'm going to go have coffee at the White House. And it's not because it wouldn't be interesting and I wouldn't want to do it. It's that emblematically, as a symbol, that isn't important. Going to the King's Court is not what's important. Overthrowing the globalist and the New World Order is what is important. Celebrating that for generations to come. And we'll have more crises to face. This is just one contest in the animating contest of liberty. What's exciting is breaking news, having whistleblowers on, changing the world. And by the way, that's what brings in the ratings. That's what brings in the funding. Not having a big guest on the show. That's what this comes down to. And so it's very refreshing to be able to sit there last night with my children in the backyard with the stars above us after dinner, and to be able to watch on a laptop different feeds of our crew live down there reporting on what was really happening. That was the enjoyment. That was the satisfaction, not, oh, I can run down there and I can be in front of some more cameras and be on the news more and maybe be in the Associated Press. And when I sit here and I explain that I don't want to be in the mainstream media, I don't care about being in the mainstream media, it's not because I'm saying I'm arrogant, I'm important. I'm only a test tube example of what will bring down this corrupt false reality. In that I've had the London Guardian, Esquire, I mean, you name it, BBC, Al Jazeera, and dozens of other major outlets in just the last few weeks call up and want to do profiles, want to do this and that. And I told them no. And they would send back numbers about, well, we have 100 million viewers or whatever. And I just said, look, make up whatever you want. I'm not going to be a set piece in your fantasy land. I'm not going to act like you really interviewed me and then pretend that you're journalists when you're mercenaries. Make up whatever you want. You don't matter anymore. You're over. It's that simple. And it's important to dust the dirt off our feet when we go in our house. It's really important to shun these people. It's really important to cut them off. And realize these are folks that have sold their souls to the most evil people this planet has ever seen. And the only way we're going to redeem ourselves is pulling out of their system. And that will bring them down. But again, I only illustrate that to explain it doesn't bring any success for my name just to be in a few more newspapers and then have them distort it. What matters is actually reaching out to real people and helping them pull back the curtain in their own life to see what's going on in the real world, not getting what we say, not taking what we say as reality, but only helping them take the blinders off. And from their rose-colored darkly, they may see something different than what we see. The point is, it's about getting out of the box, coming out of Plato's cave. That's our mission. not being up on the stage with Jimmy Kimmel. I mean, I could care less. And I'm just explaining this to the viewers, not to talk about Alex Jones, but as, again, a microcosm of how enjoyable it is to be offered a major Hollywood role and to turn it down. How enjoyable it is to break with this system entirely. Now, it knows we're breaking with it. It knows you've broken with it, and that's why it's coming in with censorship and control. The final action of tyrants, but it's too late. The intellectual bombs have already been planted, and when they try to suppress, they step on the detonator and blow their feet off. And some of these landmines jump and cut their heads off. But they push the button. They flick the domino in a fight with an intellectual movement that's bulletproof, to quote V for Vendetta. And that's what's so beautiful about God's system and God's plan. Everything works in synchronicity, together, in the great animating contest that is humanity's long march to the stars and beyond. Chelsea's in big trouble. Stay with us. Now, I just spent 5 minutes earlier talking about how I don't talk to mainstream media, hardly ever anymore. I've turned down reality TV shows, you name it, just because I know it's going to distort whatever I do. And I've already been there, I've already done that. But somebody I am talking to, because he's going to come on our show as well, is John Ronson, who's written a bunch of books that got turned into big movies like Men Who Stare at Goats, and who's the guy that about 17 years ago said, let's sneak into Bohemian Grove, because it was a year before we snuck into Bohemian Grove that he contacted me, or more than a year. I met him out at Waco covering the trial and things that were happening there with the Davidians. And he's had shows on the BBC and shows on, you name it, Channel 4. And he lives here in the United States, ran into him at the DNC, and he's written some thought-provoking articles. So he wanted to interview me, and I said, sure, let's do it. So he's going to be here with us today. That's coming up. Let me see which hour that is. That's going to come up in the third hour. David Knight hosts the fourth hour. Owen Schroyer, Carl the Cuckslayer, is going to be co-hosting with me a little bit into the next hour. He's now been officially hired as an InfoWars reporter. Folks that don't know about the meme, Abe Skrilix and Carl the Cuck, it's been seen by hundreds of millions of people online and has become quite an art piece of two, I'd have to say, mind-warped cult members, in my opinion, screaming, you're an effing white male, your opinion doesn't matter, and they're effing white males. You know, just no logic, no nothing. And I feel sorry for these guys because they've been turned into internet memes, but they did it to themselves. We didn't create the meme. Now, I've offered them money to come on air here, and I'd actually be nice to them. So it was $5,000 a piece to come here. It's now $10,000 a piece to come here and spend a day or two with us. And I'm serious about that. And that's as big as my budget goes. And I actually want to be nice to you. I want to do like a 6-hour live event with you where I try to deprogram you. I'm serious. We could almost do it like the cult deprogrammers do in a hotel room or something. You know? But I don't want to make a joke out of it. Seriously. It's just like when we got Obama phone lady here. And we took care of her, went out and got her clothes. I try to not make fun of her. She's super funny. I mean, I'm funny sometimes too. I mean, she acts like a Muppet. But it's funny. I mean, she's a lovely lady, and you know, she's been here a few times, and we really like her. I don't see Carl the Cuck and Abe Skrilix as being as lovable, but I really would try to reach out to you and explain to you how the social engineering works and what's been done to you. That's my final offer. Expenses paid, fly you here, put you in a nice hotel, $10,000 apiece to Carl the Cuck and Abe Skrilix, kings of the social justice warrior comedy gold. I mean, these people, they're better than Ghostbusters, the original. They're better than Caddyshack. They're better than Dr. Strangelove. You are gods. Do you understand this? And I want to launch your career. You, once you wake up, you can still play the part of your previous self. Like, it'd be like Paul playing Saul of Tarsus. But he was actually a professional globalist operator and kingpin and executor and torturer. That's not a good allegory. Sorry. But something like that. We could transmute you. We could engage in alchemy here on air and free you of your anti-liberal New World Order weaponized mind control. Now I'm going to stop right there. I've got so much news. It seems from the news is the most incredible. I don't get to it. Let me tell you what's coming up. These stories are up on Infowars.com right now, and they all dovetail and tie in together. This is out of the Gateway Pundit. WikiLeaks, 67 emails between Hillary and Chelsea Clinton under her fake name, Diane Reynolds. Now, when you do that, when you're operating and supposedly under government oversight, there are a lot of crimes being committed if you look into that deeper. And, of course, we know about that because newly released email show, this is from a few years ago, 2013, EPA director's extensive use of fictional alter ego. And that was to abscond from the laws dealing with Freedom of Information Act, FOIAs, which the government in mass has been rebelling against the press and the people and more not releasing them. So government patriots, most of them not Russians, most of them American patriots and others, have been hacking in and leaking the info, and now it's just a deluge. A trickle has turned into a torrent, a tempest, a monsoon, typhoon, the likes of which the world's never seen, is about to hit. But the leading edge of the storm is now upon us, and the criminals are shaking in their boots, openly saying they want to censor the internet and start arresting their detractors. Like to see you try it with that diaper on, Hillary. I am so excited. There is so much news to go over. I love the tens of thousands of emails coming out every week that just show the total organized crime, evil of the arrogant Clintons, George Soros, and others. Major European papers, Israeli papers are calling him an egomaniac, trying to bring down the world. I mean, amazing things are happening. The planet is waking up. Venezuela is disintegrating into a communist dystopia, as they always do. We have massive footage and clips that we're going to be playing from the big Trump rallies that were capacity crowds here in the ATX, Austin, Texas, yesterday. We have a ton of news dealing with globalism all over the world. That's just modern colonialism is all it is, but by corporations in serious, serious trouble. All of this and more is coming up today. We have some huge Zika news also coming up in the next hour. But I am so excited that Owen Schroyer is here. Now, I've been so busy the last 6 months since this whole Carl the Cuck thing kicked off that Rob Dew caught on a video and has since gone so viral. And so I've been somewhat following Owen's work, but not as much as a lot of other people on the internet. But all I know is we hired him. He's here. He's a great patriot, you know, in journalism school, working in radio already on air. And we've brought him down here from Missouri. And he already went out last night with the crew and just did, let's say he was a quarterback first day in the NFL. He threw 30 touchdown passes. And so it's just a great spirit with the rest of our great crew here. So it's good to have you on board.
Well, thank you, Alex. It, you know, you were my original inspiration to get into current events and politics, and this is just—it's just great to be here. I'm motivated to have people experience the same awakening process that I experienced. That there's things that matter out there more than the Kardashians, more than their local sports teams, more than Drake's latest album drop. There's things that actually affect our future and our lineage. That's what we need.
But Drake's album drops are good. I mean, I don't listen to a lot of hip-hop, but when he drops one, I do listen.
I heard that Carl the Cuck got the first initial release of the next Drake album. He's got it pre-ordered, ready to go.
Wow, I want to get into last night. I want to play a bunch of clips that you and the crew shot. There's so much to cover here, but for listeners, because we're on a lot of AM and FM stations, Christian stations, a lot of great people picking it up, they don't know about internet memes or Carl the Cuck or Aid Skrillex and what superstars these guys are and the fact that they're in hiding and won't, you know, come out of hiding. I mean, we know their real names. We're not putting them out. We don't want to hurt them. They did this to themselves. I think they really should come here.
Well, I don't know why you wouldn't come here. You've got thousands of dollars on the table. At the very least, you would think that they would do it for the very sake of having $10,000 in their bank account. I mean, I don't know an individual who wouldn't take that offer. And here's the thing that I can...
Everybody knows I pay up.
And here's the thing I continue to experience, Alex. Why is it that people feel the need? They're motivated, they're vindicated enough to go out and protest, to go out and put their voice and their face in the streets in these protests. But then when you offer them a platform, when you say, I want to hear your opinion, they cower away. They shy
away. All they
away.
Can do is scream, you're an effing white male. Last night, no one, hardly anyone, you talked to maybe 100 folks. I watched hours of the videos last night, this morning. I couldn't pull away from it. And almost no one could form any legitimate issues. They would just scream and cuss at you.
I would say I probably talked to 60 to 70 Trump protesters yesterday. I would say three of them, and I can even kind of remember in my memory who they were, but three of them, I would say, could actually hold a conversation. So I would say we're looking at three in about 65 people that protest Donald Trump can actually have a conversation. And there's plenty of points you can make against Donald Trump.
And we let them talk.
And I'm not sitting here saying Donald Trump is perfect. That's not the point that we ever make, especially when we're out on the streets like this. We're just putting a microphone out there saying, hey, look, you have a cause. You're out here protesting. You're executing your right to free speech. Here's a platform. Let's hear your points. And then what happens when we offer them that platform? They back away.
Well, the best part is
or they call me a racist.
The best part's like the 18-year-old girls that are communist, and they don't even know what it is, and then all they want to do is kiss on camera, which we were happy to show. I mean, this is crazy.
Well, and then did you notice I asked her about communism, and she didn't have a clue. I asked her about who Alex Jones was. She didn't have a clue. So she's like, I'm going to say I'm for communism. I'm going to say I'm against Alex Jones. But then I say, well, do you know who Alex Jones is? She has no idea what that is. That's just like communism. She doesn't know what communism is, but she thinks she likes it. She doesn't know who Alex Jones is, but she thinks that for some reason you're a bad guy.
We've got a lot of these clips. Did you guys just pop them over and say we have that? Yeah, let's play that for viewers. Again, most of the audience is radio listeners. I'm always reminding folks you can tune in at Infowars.com/show and some TV stations around the country and cable systems. And I haven't even really rolled that initiative out yet, but it's already happening. Strangely enough, it's the nightly news getting put on radio. Like, I never thought that would happen. It's kind of like you build it and they come, but not the way you thought they'd come. And I'm kind of conducting an interview, too, here for the newspaper reporter that's here writing a story. So we're always multitasking and breaking all this down. Let's play some of this clip. This is from outside the Travis County Expo Center in North Austin. Here it is.
We hate free speech, so we're out here protesting.
Well, you don't want Alex Jones' right to free speech.
I don't even know who the Alex Jones.
You were just chanting Alex Jones out of Austin.
Yeah, I know what I was saying. I'm not stupid.
So you say things you know nothing about?
Yeah. That's
so like communism?
Well, I'm Russian. I know plenty about that.
So you should know why communism is bad.
Yeah, I do know why communism.
So why are you out here protesting capitalism?
Why are you out here interrogating me?
Well, I'm just trying to figure out why people are protesting.
You're interrogating a 15-year-old.
All right, she's out here protesting, so why can't I ask her questions? Another unintelligent protester.
And they were sent down there by their school teacher or professor every time, and they just tell them what to go do, and then they go running out there, and they get out of their parents' Mercedes. We have video of this at other commie demonstrations. They get out of brand-new Jaguars, and then they come over and run into people, not these communists, but others, try to run into old men in wheelchairs. They always attack, like, crazed wolves, the weakest person. It's crazy.
Well, in that video too, one of those communists who had a bandana on, he comes over to me and starts trying to elbow me, the same thing he did to you. And then afterwards, I think we weren't on camera, he was talking about how, yeah, we got Jones, we got Alex, we got him good. I was like, actually, I saw the video and he pretty much ran you over like a fly. That's what I saw on video.
Even though I can't open a pickle jar. No, I didn't run them over. Those guys are not hard to run over.
Actually, I heard that they super glued that pickle jar as a gag on you, and you still got it open.
No.
That's
no,
what I
no,
heard.
No, no. No, no. Pat Riley told me that so I wouldn't feel bad. No, every 30th, 40th, 50th jar is hard to open. They bought me four of them, so I'm popping them, showing people the others. Like, wow, kind of hard. It was hard. I'm not that strong. My hands certainly aren't strong.
But it is amazing how... Again, it illustrates that these protests, I mean, at nauseam, Alex, at nauseam, we illustrate how the Donald Trump protesters are the most ignorant, the most shallow people involved in political commentary. I mean, it's just exposed time and time again. And then we get them to admit it now. This girl just admits, well, I have no idea who Alex Jones is, but I'm going to chant for him to get out of
I cannot wait until all of our great editors take that video and just string it all together, showing, I think new stars have been born here.
Well, we have plenty of opportunity to create new age Skrillexes. And you know what? Hey, look, if you're a capitalist, okay, maybe you want to be the next age Skrillex because he's got a $10,000 offer on the table to come on this show, okay?
And by the way,
so maybe that's something that
you we don't sell them, but they're super popular. I've seen age Skrillex shirts on the streets of Austin.
Yeah, the Are You Kidding Me shirt looks like Beavis and Butthead.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good one. It's a popular
I don't know. Mike Judge actually thinks they could be the new Beavis and Butthead. I don't let him in on the big secret. It might not just be an all-expenses-paid trip. You might meet with the creator of Beavis and Butthead.
Well, look, don't blame...
Oh, yeah, we want you to be real stars, gentlemen.
I don't want them, because their friends troll me, Alex. They troll me on Twitter.
Don't they understand they're about to be TV stars? They just come to Austin.
That's what I'm saying. Just embrace...
I'm not kidding. I go shooting with Mike Judge. It's not a game.
Embrace your fame.
Mike Judge thinks you're sexy.
Embrace what has happened to you. You can't avoid it. It's happened. Millions of people have seen it. You're never going to not be age Skrillex.
Fulfill your destiny. Join me, and I will complete your training.
$10,000.
Only then, cuck, will you have the true power.
Are you kidding me? You won't take $10,000 to come to Austin and then have an opportunity to expand your brand name as Carl the Cuck to a career?
You know who else is coming to Austin? Hillary Clinton.
I had absolutely no knowledge of those State Department scandals.
I believe her.
No, she has more. She always says the same thing. We could actually elect this as president.
I've never been influenced in a vote by anyone who has paid me money.
I would actually vote for that doll before I would vote for Hillary Clinton.
I can't believe I ever lied to the public.
Yeah, go ahead. We've got...
She's never lied.
Just go ahead and roll this next clip. Here it is. Why even describe it? Just go ahead and roll the next one.
All right, folks. Owen Schroyer here at Infowars.com, and I'm about to be schooled.
Anybody who's out in the Texas summer wearing a coat and tie is an idiot.
What if I got paid $1 million to do it?
I might do it for $1 million, but I wouldn't vote for Trump for $1 million.
What do you think would be a more idiotic move, wearing a suit and tie in the Texas heat or voting Clinton?
A stupid move? That's a stupid question. Where are you from?
So you didn't answer the question, though.
Oh, yes. It's stupider to wear a coat and tie.
So it's dumber for me to come out here and get a little hot, but it's not as dumb to vote Clinton, who will continue the destruction of this country.
Right. You're the stupid one.
Thank you for your time. Hey, I'm the stupid one. Hey, who did your face paint?
Me.
You did your own face paint?
I did.
Are you a professional makeup artist?
No. We were supposed to come out here looking like clowns to show what a clown Trump is, and so...
And it failed?
I'm all in.
So, do you think it's dumber to put on a suit and tie in the Texas heat or paint your face?
Suit and tie. I'm not nearly as hot as you are.
All right. Thank you, hon. You've been very good. Owen Schroyer from Infowars.com. Uh-oh.
We got to believe Texas are cussing. All right, now. What's funny is she doesn't get you dress like that and put the American flag lapel pin on to trigger them. You did that so it would bring the commies in like flies to you know what.
Well, how funny is this? I asked her if she would. She basically said she wouldn't vote for Trump for $1 million. $1 million she would not vote for Trump. And apparently I'm an idiot because I'm out in the Texas heat wearing a suit and tie like any successful businessman might be, you know, walking around town.
Well, that was just a way to attack you and then say you're not from around here or wherever. Now, expanding on this, we've got a bunch of other clips. And just to mention some of the other huge news that's coming up, and I want you to go over some of this with us. We've got the boilerplate folks with the Mexican flag saying this is Get Out of Oz line. We love Hillary Clinton. You've got that boilerplate video. We've got tires slashed with knives sticking out of them. We have the folks blocking people trying to get out of the Trump rally. And then 30 minutes after that, the police nicely come up with horses, and then they start claiming it's racist. So this is all on video. And then I've got stacks of news with the Democratic Party just invoking racism everywhere. They're teaching college courses called How to Eradicate Whiteness. And that's obviously meant to make white people racist and then make all the other groups racist so we can all be managed, again, like they do in a prison. You've got the Hispanics, you've got the black folks, you've got the white people, and everybody's divided, and that's how the warden controls things. And there's a gang leader over each wing of the prison. I don't want to live in a big, giant supermax prison or a medium security prison or anything. This is cultural control. This is just how the Romans had different areas of Rome that they used to control people and put them in their ghettos. This is old social control. We're going into it. Every Democratic-run city is a festering cesspit. Other than Austin, it's not Democrat-run. They have election fraud here. It's the most corrupt city in the country. I have seen it certified by us, by the state of Texas, fraud in Travis County, but was still certified. And I mean, I have seen the vote rigging. This is not a Democrat city. It may be because they've already brought down California like locust hitting a cornfield or a wheat field. Now they're coming. And they set right up to the same, you know, same deal. Bankrupt, destroy, waddle around, you know, human feces all over the ground, homeless people everywhere. I mean, they're running their same op again. Pump and dump, skyscrapers being built. You know, it's the same deal. This will be just implosion within 10 years now, and they'll move on to the next zone. But we are dealing with a criminal intellect, which has its doppelganger, the Republican leadership, that is the same group.
Well, and think about this. I talk about immigration, and they think I'm a racist, or they think Trump is a racist. But what they don't understand is what these immigrants or illegal immigrants, whatever you want to call them, are being used for is a voter block. So if nothing,
and we have George Soros' emails saying this,
right? So
saying we're going to overthrow your country and bring in globalism and merge all our countries and not give the Mexicans power. They're going to play all the groups off against each other and take a culture of us unifying around freedom and private property and free speech, and then just coming together in free association. They're the ones invoking race cold-bloodedly to drive us apart. But then they will referee again as the warden.
Well, it's just crazy. They'll admit the government's corrupt. And then here I am pointing out how it's corrupt, saying how I want to fix the corruption, but they think I'm racist for it. Again, I'm not racist. I'm not against immigrants. There's a legal process they can get here. But just in general, the illegal immigrants are being used for a voter block.
And they admit this. And we shouldn't have to sit here and say, we're not racist, but we can't have open borders. No one has open borders except Europe and the United States, where they don't let legal people come in. They make it hard in Europe and the U.S., and they make it easy to be illegal because the parties want to manage the illegal flow and use these people as cutouts and a new permanent displaced underclass. So it's true. It's racist and evil what's being done to third world immigrants. White, it doesn't matter, coming in, because it is a permanent underclass system meant to undercut the rest of the strata and implode the free market system that the globalists can't compete with. They've always wanted to destroy the American system, and this is an attempt to destroy the Renaissance system that hid its flower in the American system. That is what we're witnessing, is the planned demolition, destruction, absolute tenfold decimation, complete an absolute eradication of the engine of prosperity.
And most Americans will look at the dots on the map. Issues here, this is a dot. An issue here, this is a dot. But what we're seeing now is the lines connecting the dots are being exposed. We're seeing the voter blocks. We're seeing how they're rigging elections.
We have the frickin' battle plan from their top general.
In their
They have Cornwallis, and you know, we had George Washington. I mean, their frickin' general's a Nazi collaborator weirdo that thinks he's the Messiah. No, you're not. You're an old, fat, degenerate demon prepared for hell.
So you've got
with an logical, apple in your mouth, pig.
You've got logical thinking Americans who are starting to see the lines. They're starting to connect the dots, and they're realizing that Donald Trump is their best option. And then you've got people with no intellect, no research.
Do you feel the spirit of liberty rising?
I can feel it.
Ah, yeah. Oh, man. 1776 is on fire. Nothing's going to stop it. Nothing. The brush fires of liberty are raging, and 100-mile winds are coming in. The inferno is a trillion times dragon's breath. All right, Dr. Groove's going to be with us from 20 minutes into the next hour, 20 minutes into the third hour. And then we got John Ronson, who writes for The Guardian, you name it. He's a best-selling author. I think he's number one New York Times best-selling author. Written a bunch of books that I'm in one of them, Them. He wrote Minutes to Stare at Goats about some of the Army secretive operations. I will tell you, General Stubblebine says the movie's not very accurate. And it's great that I get to interview Stubblebine and John Ronson. But we'll talk about all of that coming up. But Owen Schroyer is here. Owen, we should have mentioned a little bit, just a minute or two before we get back to the Trump rally last night, some amazing clips. We've gotten a bunch of news. We're going to be breaking down 20 minutes the next hour. A little bit about yourself, though, overall.
Well, I grew up a big sports fan. My dream was to be in sports media, and I was well on track. I was on that path. I was working in sports media. But what happened was, for the first time in my life after the Boston Marathon bombing, and I mean this, for the first time in my life, I watched a news report on Fox or CNN. I paid attention to anything to do with news or current events for the first time in my life.
So there's multiple bubbles. You were totally on the sports plantation. Then you went out of that cave into a larger cave. And we're into the kind of mainstream media spectrum.
Well, what happened was I went to that spectrum for the first time and just immediately, instinctually felt I was being conned, felt I was being tricked,
felt like the things I was hearing and seeing weren't real. And it just left me scratching my head and wanting more answers. And I started digging and digging. And you know how the rabbit hole is. You start to turn things up. You start to say, oh, well, Rich DeLaurier clearly lied in the Boston Marathon bombing reports. The Judge Ortiz was the same judge who was on the Aaron, I forget his last name, the student who...
The point is, we don't know exactly what happened, but the whole thing is a cover-up,
right.
PSYOP, drills, weird stuff involved. I mean, really, really crazy.
Just crazy stuff happening. So it just led me down the rabbit hole. I started questioning everything from 9/11 to vaccines to the lines that everybody sees in the sky but never questions. And it all just led me to the rabbit hole. And I became a big fan of yours. I became a big fan of InfoWars. I became a big fan of alternative media. And I just felt that... I mean, honestly,
and we call it alternative. I mean, when it's not that alternative media is perfect,
real media,
but it's the real media. The system is more and more just absolutely bankrupt, or people in the system are deciding to make the right decision, like the CBS reporter, what Cheryl Atkinson, and then she gets fired.
Well, and
but it's okay because then she goes out and does her own thing.
What it came down to for me was I can't go on air and cover sports anymore. I can't sit here and pretend like I care, like sports is my passion, like sports is my future, and feed. Continue to feed the sheeple on this plantation.
And I'm not mad at people that watch sports. I get it. But once you're shifted out of the mind control, it's a joke.
Well, exactly. I love sports still. I still love sports. I'm not afraid to admit that I love sports. I love playing sports, watching sports. But the point is, sports don't matter. It doesn't matter. It's fun. It's entertainment. It's to, you know, muck it up with your boys.
They have over 200 vaccines they want to make forcibly injected now. California's already passed forcible inoculation laws. It's happened. It's happening in Europe. These vaccines admit on the inserts many of them can kill you or maim you. They all have horrible side effects. And they're saying we're governments that have done thousands of admitted lethal tests on their own populations, military, you name it. We're going to make you take something that mega corporations make, that the ingredients are overall secret, and we're giving them liability protection that taxpayers pay for.
Okay, so you just laid out a bunch of facts. And considering that, I looked at myself in the mirror and I said, how can I dedicate myself to sports media? How can I sit here every day and talk ad nauseum and follow sports when I've got real issues? And it's not just issues, Alex. This is attacking our livelihood. This is attacking
exactly.
our future.
And then even ABC, you talk about mainstream media, did its job a decade ago. Oh, there was a secret meeting at the CDC back in 2000 with the head of it. This was 5 years later. And he admitted, we've got to cover this up. We've caused mass autism and mass brain damage. They have all the documents. So they put out a hoax discrediting Dr. Wakefield in England, which wasn't even real. We'll be back. Stay with us. And we're here. We are facing scientific planetary tyranny, a technocracy in the New World Order's own words. The end of history. The end of life on this planet. They want the exterminism of the human race. That's the top cosmology of the New World Order. I'm not insane for saying it. They're insane for pushing it. Now, will they ever get to that point? I don't know, but it's a perfect rationale for psychopaths in control to do whatever they want. Owen Schroyer, our newest hire. We got a lot of great new reporters. All the reporters here just all working such great synergy together. I want to now cover a bunch of news because we covered some in the last hour, but let's rocket through a lot of this. First off, something I already mentioned, but it's so big, I want to hit it again with you. Newly released emails show EPA director's extensive use of fictional alter ego. She had to step down because of that. It's criminal. Well, guess what? They're using nom de plumes at the Clinton Foundation, where Chelsea's paid $6 million a year to sit in her $10-plus million apartment. Again, I'm not trying to be mean, but you know she's in training to be the new Mr. Ed. And she's up there doing all of this. And that was 1984, folks. I am being mean. This is crazy. And now we know that she's using a fake name to basically hide what they're up to. This is incredible.
Well, and it's just, you know, you can throw it on the big mountain, the stack that we have of all the corruption. But it just illustrates who the Clintons are. They're fakes. They are complete fakes. Why else would you go under a pseudonym to email your mother unless you're trying to hide something, unless you're a total fraud? I mean, that's the simple question.
Well, they're spies. Right? It's a code name. It's to throw the enemy off. And we know who the enemy is. You can look in the mirror, folks.
So we get more evidence of how fraudulent the Clintons are. We've got more deleted emails from Huma Abedin that have come out, which Clinton said never existed. She never.
And just as we broke with Stone over a month ago, it's coming out. Saudi operative. Oh.
Oh.
And when we said that it was going to come out that Hillary sent people dressed as Bernie Sanders supporters out to make Bernie look bad and Trump look bad. And then the emails came out. I'm afraid our sources were dead accurate again. Oh.
Oh, my gosh. Wait a second. You're conspiracy.
It's almost like people in the government are feeding us intel because they know that there's an occupation group in control of the country.
I'll say this. For all of the people who just want to say you're a conspiracy theorist, why don't you look, and I was saying this to people last night, why don't you look into the quote-unquote conspiracy theories that Alex Jones talks about? They always come true. They always come true. And this is just another example. I mean, do you get tired of being vindicated, Alex? I got to ask.
Well, really, they were already true. And most of the time, it's not even, it'll be in a piece of legislation. I'm not even speculating about this stuff. They said in the 60s and 70s and 80s, they wrote textbooks like Ecoscience and others saying we're putting fluoride in the water to lower their fertility and dumb them down. Well, that's in Pulitzer Prize-winning books from World War II. The Nazis did that. They learned it from Stalin during their pact with him. They, you know, let them into some of their gulags. This is all facts. They said we will give diet injections and injunctions. We'll make an uprising by the proletariat as impossible as an uprising of sheep against the practice of eating mutton. That's the big liberal Bertrand Russell, who wanted to have a nuclear war to depopulate the planet and save it. That's real liberal. Oh, man, we're going to give you injections to make you retarded so we can lord over you. That's real liberal.
Well, that's what I'm saying. The ultimate end to modern-day liberalism is, first, you're not allowed to speak, then you're not allowed to hear, then you're not allowed to see, and then you're not allowed to live. You're not allowed to breathe. I mean, that's the ultimate end to this.
Look at how they attack language. Look how they remove everything, and they create false paradigms. People say, what are you, for the Republicans? No. That's their kissing cousin. It's like a two-headed giant. That's the little drooling head. Here's the one over here that's making all the shots, the psychopath, and there's a little, yeah. You know, thinks the other heads, it's mommy.
And see, we realize this because we live in reality, but the unfortunate problem we have is so many people recognize how Republicans and Democrats are corrupt, so they just assume Trump is a bad guy because he's with the Republican Party.
He's making a run at the globalists.
Clearly.
And the big criticism, if you read some of his people I've talked to, is he just thinks they're a bunch of big sacks of garbage. Why should they be running it? And that may be why they hate him. Maybe he's just taking it over from them. Maybe it's an intramural gang battle. That's the only way Trump couldn't be for real. But still, it's a gamble. Hey, we know that. All right, folks, Alex Jones here. We are into the second hour, and we have a lot to cover, a ton to go over. Owen Schroyer, one of our great new reporters, he's known as Carl the Cuck Slayer, out there doing battle with social justice warriors, is riding shotgun with me. And then we've got Dr. Grip coming in. There's a lot of clips coming up today, a lot of clips on Infowars.com. PrisonPlanet.com, amazing social justice warrior stuff. Hours and hours of them stabbing tires, waving Mexican flags, blocking people trying to leave the Trump rally, police on horses just kind of coming up 20 feet from folks, and people screaming racist. I mean, just unbelievable media brainwashing to divide this country. But meanwhile, we're going to play some clips of what really happened inside and what was really being said inside and why the system is so scared. Break down. You were downtown, dealt with communists. We played some of those clips. You were also up at the convention center. You busted your butt with the crew yesterday. Spend a few minutes on the overall flavor of what you witnessed. I think one of these headlines shows the video. Infowars.com details it. 3 mile long lines. 3 mile lines coming in from major highways. Thousands and thousands couldn't get in. I'm told it was like 20,000 got in. And then meanwhile, maybe 100 anti-Trump people just running around spewing media talking points. And then you talk to them and they would have no response. They were programmed to say, we hate Alex Jones. We hate Donald Trump. You say, who's Alex Jones? We don't know who he is. You know, we're 15 years old. Our high school told us to come here because we're communists. Oh, the state. You know, big mega corporations have hijacked America, and they want you to wear a red bandana. You're an idiot. Go ahead.
Well, I think that, first, on a positive note, there's such positive energy coming from Trump supporters. I mean, there's such positive energy. You could feel patriotism rising. You can feel
national awakening
rising. You can feel the energy. I wasn't able to get into the expo center yesterday, but I could feel the energy that was coming out from there. 12,000 plus probably came out for this.
When I've talked to Trump, that's what he brings up. He just goes, the energy.
It's unbelievable.
He goes, have you ever felt? I go, no. It's like 20 times a rock concert.
I'll tell you what. I have felt that energy before. I felt it at a World Series. I felt it at a Super Bowl. I felt it at a Stanley Cup playoff. Donald Trump is taking that energy that all humans
have. Of optimism.
And it's, everybody has this energy. It makes your, it makes the hair stand up. It gives you butterflies. You know, you can feel it. There's some sort
People ask how he can go to 10 events a day. He is freaking high as a kite on energy.
That's what I'm saying. That's not even, that's like not even work for me going out there yesterday. I want to be out there. I want to be I'm feeling the
energy. Yeah!
This is how America was formed. And I'll, you know what? I'll give the, here's what I'll say. I'll,
and look at the globalist minions. They're poor, pathetic, dumbed down zombies. Well, I feel sorry for them.
And that's what it ultimately comes down to is, you know, we're not trying to make these people our enemies. These people aren't our enemies.
I want to see the light of liberty in their eyes.
We're on the same team as these people. And that's
Trump's inside going, he didn't flip-flop. He always said, they just cut it off. We're going to make it easier to get here legally. They've made it almost impossible so they can control the illegals coming in as a political weapon. We're not going to do that. If you're a felon, you're illegal, you're getting deported. And yeah, if we grab you, you're going to go right in. And if you're not a criminal, then boom, you can come back in. And now he's going further saying, and all of us need to hire folks and work together with citizens, everybody, and build this economy. He's saying that when he's in predominantly white cities, saying you need to hire minorities. But that's, it's not some affirmative action. He's saying hire these people, come together, not state run, but a spirit, something where we want to do it. True liberalism. They're scared of him.
Well, there's a weird dynamic happening here, too, where what we want to do is we want to break down these barriers between us and the Trump protesters, where we can start to agree on facts and agree on logic, but we can't even get to that point, Alex, because they're so brainwashed. They think we're racist because we support Trump. They buy into the media spin that you just illustrated. So I can't even engage these people on the level to bring us all on the same team and move forward together.
And there's hours of this just from last night on Infowars.com. And the crew's welcome to roll some of the B-roll in the background for TV viewers. But let's go ahead and start getting to what was happening inside that these poor people never get to see on national news. Because they don't show hardly anything Trump says except little clips out of order to deceive people.
I only saw one media outlet yesterday. You know who that was? Infowars.com. I didn't see any other media source there yesterday. No one.
It's incredible. They'll have a few inside to distort it, and that's it. This is so evident. The entire enemy system is freaked out. Now, this is R.W. Bray, who I want to get on. I want to get this going for a while. Black Trump supporter says liberal politics and the Democratic Party. Let's play that clip.
Coming up to me and cursing at me and calling me racist. Why won't you comment? Why are you banging a drum? Is it hot out here? All right, this guy will provide me nothing. You're out here. I don't understand people that I'm not in your face. Calm down.
Okay. And I'd ask for two clips and confused them. That's we've got hours where people will not respond. They will not talk. Almost any of them because they've been told don't talk. They've been sent there by the Soros Foundation, by the communists. I mean, we've seen this over and over again over the years. Communists will never talk to you or they'll just threaten you. Now, let's go ahead and play the clip of R.W. Bray. There's several of these clips. Here it is.
There was a time I can mention the names of William Lord Garrison or Frederick Douglass, and people would know exactly who I'm talking about. But that was 170 years ago. And along with our hats and our coats, we've hung up our values and our morals. Same morals that have made America great. I can't help but believe that maybe there's some return to that. But those names are all but been erased in the chronicles of history. But make no mistake about it, slavery has returned. And she is more vicious than ever before. Because this time she is colorblind.
Well, this time it's scientific. They call it a technocracy. The globalists do. Here's another clip of R.W. Bray speaking about the Clintons' war on drugs, which is the minimum sentencing that they said was to make black people heal like a dog. Now, imagine if Trump said something like that. It'd be the end of the world. Here's that clip.
Jim Crow laws, like the Clintons' war on drugs, has incarcerated millions of black men. Has left millions of women without husbands. Millions of children fatherless.
And the weaponized media to push it.
The reason why 1.5 million black men are not in our communities is because of the war on drugs. That's the Democrats' full-out assault against the black man.
And let's be honest, the Republicans are big in it too, Nixon.
It is their emasculation of everything that the culture of blacks stand for. They have been emasculated, an entire culture.
Well, the whole culture is. It's black people. Look at the metrosexual thing, all of it.
What will we do about it?
This is key, because Trump is a vote against the globalists. All right. Now, look at this and understand that, yes, it was a Democrat plan, but the Republicans picked it up and ran with it because they can make money out of it, get control. And there's plenty of, you know, institutional classism, I would call it, but not from the liberal perspective, from a social engineering perspective. And people think of advertising, like the ads we have coming up in a few minutes, as the ads. But when you get into MTV and all this, it's product placement. And they rolled out gangster rap to take over rap that was all about empowerment and art to sell the entire war on drugs right as the cocaine hit the streets. This is declassified. Absolutely. This has all come out. It's not our opinion. I've interviewed Free Ricky Ross, the real Rick Ross, all of it. And notice MTV put out a fake Rick Ross to cover up his story. This is an info war, people. This is an info war. And the British East India Company controlled world opium. Then they controlled cocaine. They took down China by getting China to make drugs illegal. And then they brought the drugs in to control things. And then that corrupted the government. This is a takedown of society. And they targeted the neighborhood folks wouldn't really watch, or the neighborhood that was segregated, the neighborhood where they could beta test it. But it's been exported everywhere, and it's pure evil.
Well, and listening to R.W. Bray and most logical thinking black people have realized what you're talking about, and they know that that's how kind of their culture has been devalued and disintegrated. But just listening to R.W. Bray there, I mean, I just wanted to stand and cheer. That guy almost was brought to tears.
Imagine if they put that on CNN. Imagine, but there's a blockade. And really, who votes for Trump? People that watch mainstream media.
And look at this.
I mean, who's going to vote for Clinton? People that watch mainstream media. Because you're not going to get the Trump information there.
The people who are brainwashed by the mainstream media are the ones that will vote Clinton because they've seen the spin against Trump. But what's amazing to me, R.W. Bray and the people who speak at Trump events, they get up there and they're impassioned. They are real. You can feel the emotion. You can feel the energy. You can just tell that their presence is a presence of patriotism and liberty.
Absolutely.
And restore American nationalism. You listen to people at Hillary Clinton's rallies or
gibbering fools.
They have nothing to say. They have like one liner like, oh, that was a great song by Demi Lovato. And then they go right into their canned speech. R.W. Bray just got on the stage and laid it all on the line. He put his soul out on the line. He almost was brought to tears.
That was real.
So real. That's what I love. That's what resonates.
Well, that's it. And Trump's bringing all that in. So whether you think he's good or bad, the horse he's riding on is the real deal.
And that's the ultimate point, too. I'm not sitting here saying that Trump is my savior. I'm not saying that Trump is perfect. I'm saying that Trump is the only chance, at least I believe.
The entire power structure is throwing everything they've got at him worldwide because they know he's real. And even if they steal it from him and he loses, which I don't think is going to happen, this is world-changing what's happened. Owen Schroyer, it's very exciting to have you here on the team. We're going to be talking a lot more. And you say you want to work 15 hours a day. We're ready to do it. You're going to be hearing a lot more from this young man. Tell folks how old you are.
I'm 27 years old.
That's good. You're a little bit later start than me. I've been on air since I was 21. But imagine what you'll be doing in 20 years. We'll be back with Dr. Edward Group, a ton of news, and a bunch of clips. We haven't even gotten to them yet. My good buddy, Jimmy Vaughn, bringing us in. What a patriot. He was over at the house last week. Ian Robin, just pointing out how many great anti-New World Order folks there are out there. He's been aware of the New World Order for like 16, 17 years. Been fighting. He's not a late comer to the fight, just to point out how many great patriots there are around the world that are awake. For the next hour, we are joined in studio by Dr. Edward Group. Now, I already skipped a break last hour. I haven't plugged anything. Most talk radio, you would have heard plugs during each segment, and that's fine. They have to fund themselves with sponsors, with advertisers to bring money in. I get so focused on the news and battling for the Republic that I don't refill our gas tank and fund our operation. So I'm going to give you a hard pitch, and I'm going to give myself a hard pitch for Selenium. The more I take the vitamins and minerals and products at InfoWars Life that are always sourced to be the purest, most organic, most bioavailable, the better my life gets. Now, the problem is, I've got like 25 products, and they're all really excellent, and I just have to make myself through three meals every day to remember to, you know, carry the caplets and tinctures and things with me. And everybody can see I look a lot better. I have more energy. I'm not saying I'm a beach boy, but I've lost 70-something pounds, and it's been amazing. And we were, for months and months, developing with Dr. Grubb BioTrue Selenium. Now, a lot of things at InfoWarsLife.com, like DNA Force and Lung Cleanse and Supermel Vitality, are super proprietary, game-changing, cold-pressed, just amazing. That's why they get five stars on nutraceutical and what I would call you know, supplement Nazi sites. I don't mean literal but Nazis, but like Seinfeld, folks that are really into it, people that are experts, you know, almost in an obsessive way. They love what Dr. Grubb has helped us develop. A lot of it, again, is complex molecules, acids, you name it. This is just bioavailable from mustard seed, the best selenium that we could bring you. We believe it's the best out there at a very, very low price. And when you look into selenium, it's like just like iodine. It's a key missing link. You're the expert. But what's crazy, this is serendipity, synchronicity. This actually happened 5 minutes ago during the break, and I'm going to give you the floor. People are always like, shut up and let group talk. But I've got to tell people, this just went up. Kit Daniels, August 24th, 2016. He's writing about this breaking in major studies today. You were set a month ago to come and pitch selenium when it finally got here, and it got here last week. This was a month ago, and you were going to talk about this before even this study to show how cutting edge you are. Study, selenium may stop Zika birth defects. Low dietary selenium could be at risk factor for Zika-related defects, says UNC study. Prestigious. Now, I'm going to stop right there. But you talk about just, is it serendipity or synchronicity? I mean, this is insane. That it broke in the news today is just crazy. But this is just an example. I've read the studies where if you don't have selenium, you get colon cancer. If you do, it's like the numbers are insane. Now, I'm not pitching this as a cancer cure. What I'm saying is if you don't have water, you'll die. If you don't have vitamin C, you'll get you know, diseases where your teeth fall out and everything disintegrates, scurvy. And selenium is another one of those absolute must-haves, and the studies show all-time record low in the Western world. Breast cancer, you name it. It is, my children and I are going to be taking, we've been taking another brand until this came out. I'm taking it now every day. This is so key. Now, for the rest of the hour, Dr. Grubb, you have the floor, my friend.
Well, it all starts with trying to find the best selenium out there. It's iodine is extremely important to the thyroid gland, and everybody has their own special trace minerals that they really like and that are really important in the body. And we've had the X2 Survival Shield, and we've had so many requests over the years for selenium. What took me so long is I wanted to find the best bioactive selenium that was out there. And just recently, we were able to source a certified organic bioavailable selenium from mustard seed extract. Selenium is an extremely important trace mineral in the body. We are becoming deficient in selenium all over the world. As a matter of fact, there was an article just recently that
when we come back, we'll have time for you to go through your 50 articles. I mean, we've got mainline studies here. But now I've been reading the studies. I'm not an expert like you, but isn't it that most of it's synthetic that they're selling and it doesn't do anything, basically?
Yeah, most of it's synthetic, and the majority of the population actually has selenium deficiency. There's just not enough in it. You can get it from seeds, you can get it from seafood, you can get it from eggs, a few different sources. But the problem is, especially with all the spraying out there, is that, and by the way, we're not making any health claims here, the aluminum is so high in the bodies from all of the deodorants and all the cooking and all of the chemtrails that are falling down.
The industrials.
It's literally reacting with the selenium in the soil.
It's bonding.
And it's bonding, and it's creating a deficient source of selenium.
Oh.
I'll tell you this article that just came out. Which
wonder why the New World Order keeps hitting us with it.
You can really link it because Alcoa was involved in selenium research.
And then they came out with the fluoride in the water.
Yeah, and by the way, selenium reacts with fluoride and bromine as well because uh-huh.
And then the White House science czar wrote a book and admitted he's doing it to us called Ecoscience. Oh, he wrote a book saying it. It's not my opinion. He hit us hard, and he gets to laugh at all the brain damaged people. We'll be right back. A new world order. If that isn't 1984, what is? There's no New World Order, but the president's calling for a planetary government called the New World Order, and now the Pope's calling for it, and it's unelected megacorporations that legalize slavery again in the TPP. And we're bad kooks because we told you the NSA was secretly spying on you, exactly as it's now come out they were, because I had NSA whistleblowers on in the 90s. But they wouldn't arrest them. I was eating during the break. Shouldn't do that. Then they wouldn't arrest them. They would just ignore them, not a group.
So what I was saying, an interesting article that I found was a paleontologist was looking at selenium levels, and it says, did a missing trace element, selenium, trigger mass extinctions? Not to be fear-mongering or anything, but what he determined was the cause of the three mass extinctions on the history of the Earth was actually a selenium shortage, which crippled the life on Earth. So I just want to let people know how important of a trace mineral this is. You know, Dr. Wallach.
Hey, guys, show a video shot of that. Yeah, go ahead.
Dr. Wallach was doing research on selenium back in the day with cystic fibrosis, and he was fired from his laboratory working on monkeys because he realized that giving monkeys selenium and the pregnant mother's selenium, he could reverse cystic fibrosis. And an interesting story he tells also is with muscular dystrophy. Everybody remembers
Sure, if they got it in utero, then they wouldn't get it. They had to have it while they were being developed.
Also, if they were still young. If they were still young, they could reverse muscular dystrophy. And that's, you know, I haven't seen the research on that, but I know that Jerry Lewis was actually fired in 2011, and he wasn't able to do any more of those.
It's just like breast cancer.
If you look into the Muscular Dystrophy Association, which I did, I mean, it's pretty crazy how they distribute money and how they take advantage.
Well, let's expand on this and then walk through it all. And again, we have the new product at InfoWarsLife.com, but wherever you get it, get true organic selenium, okay?
Yeah.
We have what we believe is the very best out there, and it supports the InfoWar, so it's a 360 win. BioTrue Selenium is the product, exclusively available at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. And please, after you go through these studies, and give folks the sources, obviously, we're showing these on screen for TV viewers, the radio listeners, obviously, you can see this video later today when it's posted on the site if you want to follow along even closer. This synergistically works with true iodine. And so this supercharges and goes together. Please continue, Dr. Group.
So selenium works directly with iodine. And selenium, the highest concentration of selenium is in the thyroid gland, but it's actually used all over the body. As a matter of fact, there's 25 genes in the body that are directly dependent upon selenium. So it really is a all-around nutrient that everybody really needs in their body. The strange thing, you know, we talked about the Zika, and it's how the Zika was patented by the Rockefeller Foundation. The
1954
Foundation is funding some of, in conjunction with Monsanto, who sprayed all of the larvicide on the area in Brazil where the individual children had microcephaly, the shrunken brains, basically. When you start looking at Zika and then Zika now coming to the United States, what I've uncovered is there's a sinister plan with the Zika, because the Zika virus can actually cause infertility because it alters the selenoprotein. So when you take selenium in the body, it's turned into enzymes, and it works with the glutathione peroxidase as well. So it actually benefits the detoxification systems in your body. It stimulates the liver. It helps balance the thyroid gland. It helps detoxify. As a matter of fact, there's a lot of studies out there how selenium works as an anti-cancer preventative. And as a matter of fact, the FDA actually allows claims for selenium. Believe it or not, they were sued a long time ago by a FDA lawyer, Jonathan Emord, which is a great activist.
He's an amazing guy. We've had him on before.
Dietary supplement field. So you're actually allowed to say that selenium reduces the risk of certain cancers and selenium has anti-carcinogenic effects. Couple other things that I really like about it is it actually recirculates your vitamin C in your body, and it recirculates the glutathione.
Again, I've read the studies. I'm not an expert like you, but explain this to me. That's why I was mentioning it earlier. Vitamin C with the true iodine, with the selenium, these are all these three key things that all cofactor and work together. And then if you don't have them, you die. I mean, these are absolute building blocks. And the point is that there's massive low levels of selenium. Let's get back into your studies, and we're going to do a document cam shot for TV viewers. And then let's also go over Kit Daniels' article that links into the UNC study, because this is amazing. The study, which was released in July but received scant media attention, and again, I just saw it in the news today, and Kit wrote about it, says that Zika mimics a genetic disease known as PCCA by lowering selenium proteins known as, and then it goes through the type of proteins. This is amazing. Let's talk about all that. Dr. Group?
So basically what the research suggests in this, and I have another form which is a little more detailed than that, is, and we had no idea this was coming out. I mean, this is basically brand new stuff. This is what kind of scares me about the Zika thing, because you know, I know that a lot of the Zika research, some of it is a hoax when you look at...
Oh, sure. They're hyping it up, absolutely.
But we know that they want to develop a vaccine for it. But I tell you what they don't want people finding out is that selenium will deactivate and prevent the Zika virus from doing any damage. Because what it does is the trace mineral selenium, which has been shown actually to improve the clinical outcomes in HIV and AIDS and several other viral diseases.
You're reading from the prestigious study.
From the study, could also be useful in reducing the risk of neurological disorders. Because if you just look at the Zika virus and you take away the pesticides and all the other stuff that's associated with microcephaly, the Zika virus itself, and what's really scary too is the genetically modified mosquitoes that they've made, because they've altered the genes in these GM mosquitoes to attack the mosquitoes with the Zika.
So, by the way, I'm sitting here like we're in a science fiction dystopia. I've studied all this. I read this every day. It's in mainstream news. And it just sounds crazy. The Rockefellers patented it, weaponized it, and then created a genetically engineered mosquito with it. And now it's suddenly out of control. And then they're obsessed with selenium and iodine and fluoride, which counters those. And you see their program. I mean, these people are, and then they write books bragging how they were going to do it to us. It is so unbelievable. The bottom line is, folks, I don't care where you get the selenium. Filter your water. Don't drink hydrofluorosilicic acid. Harvard now admits massive IQ reductions. Harvard even admits you can pull these studies up as well. Harvard, I just use that because there's so many studies on how iodine deficiency lowers IQ on average 15 points. Look it up for yourself. And then the FDA keeps lowering it down, 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 down. I guess they'll soon say we don't even need it. This is crazy town, Dr. Group.
Selenium, too, causes mental retardation and mental problems. What we're seeing
you mean
now...
fluoride?
Fluoride? Well, no, I was saying selenium deficiency.
Deficiency.
Selenium deficiency also causes mental retardation and severe selenium deficiency.
What is the molecule like? I mean, what...
It's actually a trace mineral, and it's listed as a semiconductor.
And we're electrochemical.
That's why it's so important, and it's used in multiple phases, especially.
By the way, Anthony keeps always going, take your selenium, and let's just say it. X2 gives me a lot of energy. People almost like, don't take selenium, Alex. I've been bouncing off the walls lately. This stuff is amazing.
Well, because a lot of people with thyroid disorders, iodine is great, and iodine will help balance the thyroid, and that's one of the main things that we're seeing right today in across the board. I mean, endocrine disrupting chemicals, which are the thyroid is an endocrine gland, lack of deficiencies in trace minerals. There's 91 trace minerals out there. A lot of them you can get with Himalayan crystal salt. You can get with organic apple cider vinegar. You can get with fulvic acid. That's why we put trace minerals in all the products that you have, Alex, because we put the fulvic acid in there so they get these trace minerals. Selenium is only needed in microgram amounts. It's needed in 200 micrograms.
So we're talking about almost an adjuvant or an activator.
We're talking about a trace mineral that's responsible for multiple actions in the body. It has been shown to be fight against carcinogens. Deactivated.
Obviously, Linus Pauling won the Nobel Prize for this, but he said you couldn't take too much vitamin C. I don't know, it could upset your stomach if you take too much. What is the dose you can take of this, and can you take too much selenium?
You can, I think, take too much selenium because it is a trace mineral. I recommend anything from 200 to 400 micrograms a day, but I'd rather stay on the safe side. Some doctors out there right now are recommending a gram, which is 1,000.
So I've already taken two pills a day. Is that too many?
That's 400 micrograms. That's fine. Nothing's going to go wrong with that, and that's probably a good dose for you. It does stay in the body for, you know, a few days, so it's something that the body can easily process, and most likely you're not going to be taking too much of it. But listen, there is a lot of information out there on selenium and how it works in the body.
By the way, John Ronson's a really smart guy, best-selling author, and he never even heard of selenium. And that's an example.
Before we started putting all the information out there about iodine, no one really knew about iodine. All they knew was that you...
Now you go to Whole Foods, they got 10 products of it. But I'm going to be honest, it's potassium iodide that you don't absorb that isn't as good. We would sell that. We knew iodine was key. It's why we developed this. We would be selling the other stuff. We have it for nuclear attacks and things, but that's an emergency potassium iodide. People come up to me and say, is this good? And I've asked you about it. It's not that they're competitors. It's we would be putting that out too. It's not as good as our iodine, RX2. Tell people how X2 goes together with our BioTrue selenium from InfoWarsLife.com.
It's basically iodine and selenium work together as a team. So if you have a team that you're going to have repairing and balancing out your endocrine system, your thyroid gland, you want to have that team working together. So I would have had selenium out a long time ago. We would have even put it in with the X2. The problem is...
We tried that. In fact, I said, I want X3. I want to make it better. And we just can't do it with selenium.
And listen, it's, you know, many, many people get, there's so many benefits of just selenium in itself. It's a fantastic immune modulator. Believe it or not, it has a lot to do with fertility and infertility. I've also linked that to the...
I know women that go to fertility doctors and they tell them take selenium. And I want to expand on something. I'm really proud of what we do. I've been told by industry leaders, some of the biggest retailers in the country who've asked us to consult for them, I don't have time to do it, that just what you said, we have made iodine now be in all the Whole Foods and all the basic shops. It was not there 3 years ago. We have changed the market on that. I guarantee you with selenium, we start pushing this. It's such a service to the public. And they should tell people about selenium as well. Wherever you get your selenium, this is key, ladies and gentlemen. Do your own research. And we've come up with the very best selenium that we possibly could. Dr. Group believes it's probably the best out there. We're talking nutraceutical level, incredibly bioabsorbable from a natural form, from an organic form, the mustard seed. But regardless, it's funding this broadcast. But tell people they need to filter their water with a system that cuts out fluoride and bisphenol A and all the garbage that's in the water and the Roundup, which they now admit is growing the breast cancer and the rest of it. They knew that when they approved it. That's all come out. Whatever you do, this is a war. Warn people about what's going on. Tell them about what's happening. Look at Hillary. They admit her real health problem is hyperthyroidism, what you mentioned.
I really believe I've had a lot of people ask me, speaking of the Hillary health scenario, what's going on with her, and I've kind of watched her, and it seems like to me she's definitely has some issues going on with her. Did you ever see that movie Concussion with Will Smith?
No, I didn't.
Yeah, that was a really good. Anytime you have a concussion, well, first they say she was dehydrated and she fainted. I personally don't believe that she was dehydrated fainted and hit her head.
But WikiLeaks just came out with the fact that she was looking for Parkinson's medication.
Yeah. I mean, the all of the symptoms you can clearly see. The hypothyroidism that's taking a place. I think she might have been exposed to radiation when she was visiting Fukushima. As well as many other things.
That was crazy. Why did they bring U.S. ships right up to it? Why did Hillary go over there?
She went over there with Kennedy, actually, Carolyn Kennedy, I think. And but we know now the devastating effects of what's happening with Fukushima and all the stuff that's going on.
Now, wait a minute. Ann Coulter said the Japanese should be thankful for that. I don't want to bash Ann Coulter. She does some good stuff on guns. But, she said the Japanese ought to be thankful radiation's good for you.
That's just like a medical profession that says pharmaceuticals are good for you and everything else. I mean, the reason you don't see all this stuff in the mainstream, like you said,
it's in competition with them.
They do not want this information out there.
What about the numbers I've seen in mainline studies about people that take selenium and the reductions in cancers? We're not making health claims. We're reading news articles.
Look, there's a great site. It's called seleniumresearch.com, and you can go there and look at all of the studies for breast cancer studies. There was a study that they determined if they were to give 200 micrograms to every 14-year-old girl on the planet, it would reduce breast cancer by like 85%. It would almost wipe out breast cancer just with selenium. I wrote some stuff down here. I mean, these are published in the journal in JAMA, show that daily supplementation of 200 micrograms of selenium cut the cancer death cancer death rate in half. Now, is that not a threat to the pharmaceutical companies and the in chemotherapy? Lung cancer incident was reduced by 46%. Prostate cancer incident was reduced by 63%. Colon cancer reduced by 58%. 17% reduction in all causes of mortality. Selenium is required in 25 of our genes. I'll tell you another thing that I saw. The University of North Carolina did a study, and because we always talk about vaccines and we always talk about the flu season, which is now year round with all the influenza viruses that have been released everywhere. When the influenza virus encountered mice deficient in selenium, it mutated and emerged more virulent. So you talk about all the super bugs that are out there. So let's say you get influenza and you're deficient in selenium, and then you cough and you spread that virus. It's even stronger and more
virulent. Wow, it's mutating inside of you like a embryonic petri dish. And again, as a layperson just reading the studies and seeing the headlines, this is a fact. I mean, they admit it. You don't have vitamin C, stuff breeds inside of you. You don't have selenium, it breeds inside of you. So whether it's the flu or whether it was Zika, it is giving your body the normal electrochemical power your cells and mitochondria and neurons need. And when you don't have it, it's like not having a battery charge in your car. It's not cranking.
Yeah, that's what I like about the DNA Force, too, is because it protects the DNA. But selenium is another one of those products that protects the DNA. Here's a study that selenium may react directly with carcinogens to prevent their binding to DNA. I mean, that's huge right there. Reactive selenium metabolites can render carcinogens non-carcinogenic. Selenium can raise the levels of xenobiotic enzymes in the liver for detoxification of carcinogens. Selenium after iodine...
Skip this break. It's too important.
...is the most important mineral affecting thyroid function.
Thyroid. Selenium is a necessary component of the enzymes to remove iodine molecules from T4 converting into T3. Explain that.
Well, that's how selenium works with iodine. It helps convert the T4 to the T3 in the thyroid. And it does that by working with...
And if your body doesn't have it, your thyroid will absorb fluoride, bromide, bromide, all the bad halogens they're pumping out at us. And then we wonder why hyperthyroidism and these goiters, and you look at women, beautiful women, young ones now, have these, even if they're skinny, these giblets hanging down, and the government just says, we're going to put you on thyroid medication, sweetheart.
And you know, most pharmaceutical medications actually, especially the ones for mental illnesses, anxiety, fluoride, depression, are made of fluoride. It's really hard.
Are you saying it was wrong in the Soviet gulags that they gave people fluoride in the water? Because Stalin loved people, right?
I don't know. You tell me.
Well, I tell you, Dr. Grip, it is just so crazy to sit here and know that no matter how crazy all this sounds, it's what's going on.
Selenium also helps with mercury detoxification as well. So if you take selenium away, think of all the people that have mercury amalgam.
People are always asking how the Japanese can eat the most mercury in the world, but live the longest, but other people have lower mercury, but end up getting sick from it in the West. And that's what I was reading in another study. In fact, he was just mentioning it earlier about how he eats seafood. It has the selenium in there with the mercury to counteract it. Fish have that, right? It's amazing. So there's selenium right next to the mercury, exactly. So God counteracts it.
Yes. Yeah.
So that's how you can eat that type of fish and not get sick. It's incredible. I'm sorry, you were trying to get there. Go ahead.
What I'm saying right now is that, everything is polluted, and that's the whole purpose of what we're doing here and what we're trying to bring to people is that we're doing the research and finding out what you need and what's going to be helpful and what they're, like you said, this study with the selenium and Zika, the association between those two is posted on the WHO website. I mean, the World Health Organization. It's not like they're trying to hide it from...
Yeah, guys, Google worldhealthorganization.org or .gov. I forget which one it is. They have both, I think. And then type in Zika, selenium, search engine. It'll take you to the subpage. So I want to show TV viewers this. We're not playing games. And I want to just tell you something. They've had national news stories. I think are so comical the way they write them, going, Alex Jones tells people that you have deficiencies and that it's hurting you, and then he sells you things for the problem. Yeah, I thought that's what you do. Like, if I owned a dog shop or a pet shop, I would sell things for pet owners. I mean, exactly. I'd go out and find the very best water filters at the lowest price that I personally use, and then I sell it to fund our overall operation to keep warning people. It's like they don't get the 2 plus 2 equals 4. They don't get a 360 win. They think you've got to screw somebody over. No, I take my products. I want to have the best nutraceuticals at the lowest price. And I'm not a sociopath. I'm somebody that really cares about people. But if I was a sociopath and smart, I would still do that, because then I'll have the best products with the best ratings at the highest quality. If the FDA or whatever comes in and tests, I'm going to have all the tests, all the proof, all the stuff ready with the former FDA lawyers running it all. I mean, we're talking about, loaded for bear, because we know we're a target. It's crazy. They don't get it, because other nutraceutical companies call us up, as you know, and they say, the average markup is 7 times. Why are you only marking it up 100%? And I go, because I'm going to put super high-quality products in and still have a decent price, and then I'm going to take the market over. And they go, yeah, you are. Please stop. I mean, these people just don't. It's called Renaissance, people.
The majority of the people in the nutraceutical industry, I'm not trying to bash the nutraceutical industry.
It's unbelievable.
But you and I are both, we have a cause, and I'm not.
Tony Montana said, I have never screwed anybody over before, didn't have it coming to him. I will go around somebody that's attacked me instead of messing with them unless I have to run over them. I'm not looking to prove scores. I'm not looking to do this and that. I'm not looking. No. I am absolutely mission-oriented, 360 win. I treat people how I want to be treated. And it's not even a philosophy. It's my DNA. It's who I am. And I grew up thinking everybody was like me, and I learned they're not. And they wonder why they're losers. If you're a scumbag and a backstabber, you're a scumbag backstabber. Stop being one. Sorry, group.
No, it's just that, I feel I was born to, my dad was involved with the invention of phthalates and plastic.
By the way, I looked that up years ago when I first was talking to you, like 10 years ago. Your dad was a very famous chemist.
Yeah, and actually my family was, it comes from the Webster family. Noah Webster was my great-great-great-great-great-grandfather, and Pelatiah Webster was the one that wrote the original Constitution of the U.S. But my family had...
Your dad came up with bisphenol A, basically.
Yeah, my dad was one of the top developers for plastics, PVC.
It was Exxon, right?
With Exxon, yeah. He was one of the chief chemists with that. He actually did work for the government, too, and I think he was put away because he ended up getting cancer.
That's what they do when you get older. They just spike old cannons.
Yep.
All these guys that in the CIA and stuff and think they're going to be left alone, they just come kill you.
Actually, I found the report probably 6 months ago. He was about to come out and say that the plastics do have cancer-causing...
we ought to publish that.
Yeah, I need to, actually. I mean, so I knew at least he knew. He knew.
And then literally the Men in Black showed up.
Oh, yeah. There was a group of probably 15 when he died. People that were at my mom's house, and just a stack of documents this thick that they were forcing her to sign. Yep. But anyway, back to the whole purpose of what we're doing here is I've devoted my life to helping people. I mean, really, it's not about making money.
But it's not bad to do that either. We need to make money.
We need to help more people.
To expand the operation and be strong in the face of the globalist. It's a total 360 win. But all I'm saying is whatever you do, get your selenium somewhere. And how do people tell? They don't even give it from us. Let's advertise for folks wherever they're at in the world. How do you know when you're reading the label that it's bioavailable from an organic source?
So if you're going to go anywhere and get selenium, the best one that you can get is selenomethionine. It's basically a bonded selenium, and that's the majority out there. There are selenium selenites and other different forms out there. Don't get any of those. There might be a couple other sources out there where you can get fully plant-reacted bioselenium, which is the one that we have here.
Basically, in layman's terms, this is organic, pure rocket fuel from the plant.
Straight from the mustard seed. It's actually certified organic.
And think about in the Bible,
organic.
The tiny mustard seed Christ uses as an allegory can grow in this huge tree. And people have always marveled that mustard seed, as they say, is the most powerful seed out there for its size, what it does. One of the smallest seeds that makes something huge. I think that shows the power of selenium.
It does. It does.
The mustard seed is powered by selenium.
It is. It is. Selenium is
essential.
And so the more that you can do to stay away and avoid all these things is obviously really, really good. I mean, like you were saying, you want to stay away. It's really hard, actually, to stay away from chlorine and bromine and fluoride.
We're just bathing.
Everything.
It's everywhere.
If anyone goes out to eat at any restaurant, you are going, I don't care what restaurant it is, you're going to get, thousands of parts.
We got to go to break. Stay there. Come back and finish up on this. Then I want to shift into other news, and we're going to stop plugging selenium, but it's more than just plugging. It is a public service announcement. that you need vitamin C, you need water, you need pure water, you need selenium, you need X2, you need pure, true iodine, and we're the only folks that have it. I mean, it's the real deal from Deep Earth Crystal Sources, unbound, right in there, so it all fuses together. The two available right now at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. Also support our local sponsors on local AM and FMs. We'll be back. Stay with us. I personally have been talking about doing my own lay research in mainstream news, science news, the federal government's own admissions, the UN's own admissions. This stuff's out there. There's actually a lot of good people in the government. We've had the majority of the scientists at the FDA come out and say, in the last two decades, over and over again, and their unions have come out and said, take hydrofluorosilicic acid, commonly known as fluoride, out of the water. This is crazy. But then they just call us kooks. They call us nuts. Fine. Consult your physician on whether I'm right, because I'm not your physician. This is me personally talking, that you need water, that you need oxygen, that you need vitamin C, that you need selenium, that you need true bioavailable iodine. Consult your physician, again, that you need oxygen, but be sure and keep breathing while you're making that phone call to the physician. And so we're not making health claims. We're not making medical claims here. We're simply talking about the news we're reading, the studies we're looking at that say this, and the fact that the government itself, this is one of the few things, even though they're Nazis about this, that they admit, okay, you can say that selenium has been associated as anti-cancer. It's that powerful. So wherever you get the selenium, do your own research, consult your healthcare practitioner, whatever type that may be that you think is most important. Talk to your medical doctor. And there are a lot of medical doctors I've talked to that rave about selenium. There's a lot of good MDs. We're not against Western medicine. We're simply saying it's become a corporate monopoly. Dr. Group, please continue.
No, that's what I was saying. There's one other thing I wanted to add about the selenium, and that's it's not a strange thing, but it's a very interesting thing, is that this was an article that came out. It said, when selenium is scarce, the brain battles the testes for it. And faced with a shortage of the essential nutrient selenium, the brain and the testes duke it out. In selenium-depleted male mice, testes hog the trace element, leaving the brain in the lurch, scientists report.
That's why I'm so tired.
Journal of Neuroscience. And the reason why that's very interesting is because never before have they found that the body actually fights, or two organs fight each other for a trace mineral. So they found that for the first time,
selenium, the body says procreation is more important than you living.
Exactly, exactly. So by the way, if the Zika virus, you know, talking about the population control, just going off on a tangent here because I did link this up. If the Zika virus, which they're, you know, heavily working with somehow or another to spread everywhere, and now they're, you know, spraying all kinds of larvicides and stuff in Florida.
But they're telling us that the pesticide doesn't hurt us.
Well, they should just give everybody selenium, and then then they'll be protected. But the thing is, the Zika virus will deactivate and cause you to become infertile.
Oh, and it's so weird the Rockefellers and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation are involved.
Exactly, exactly.
They're just obsessed with it, and then magically it happens. It's funny.
So another news that I wanted to talk about today was the diagnosis of 9/11-linked cancers have tripled in less than 3 years. And the reason I wanted to bring this up to everybody, just some health news, is because I have family in New York City, and I know a lot of people in New York City, and a lot of them are having problems since 9/11.
Oh, nosebleeds.
More than 5,400 Ground Zero responders and others who lived, work, or went to school near the fallen Twin Towers have come down with 9/11-linked cancers. 5,400. I mean, you remember after 9/11 when they were saying, oh, yeah, it's people were asking, can we go outside? They said, oh, yeah, it's safe to go outside. You can walk around. Well, what was in all those explosives? What was in those cloudy, gray, white plumes of smoke everywhere? I don't know. I'm guessing there was a lot of arsenic. There was a lot of other contaminants and chemicals in there.
Well, we do actually know. I'll talk about it after the break, but go ahead.
But what I'd like to do is just let people know, listen, if you live in the New York area, you know, do your research, go online and type this in. Everything that we talk about, you can do to cleanse your body. Everybody has a self-healing mechanism. Your kids, if you have kids living in New York, make sure that you take the necessary action to cleanse them out, eat clean food, and try to prevent any of this from happening to you.
And what about steam rooms? I've heard those are really good.
Steam rooms are great.
I put in like a $400 unit in my shower, and it's awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
That's something really ought to sell near those. That's a way to...
You can buy near-infrared lamps right now on eBay and Amazon, and you can just sit in front of them, and it helps you decompress.
Absolutely. And again, we take the market over by selling things that are good and help people. You know, I was thinking this morning when I was on InfoWars.com going through the 50 or so YouTube videos we put out yesterday alone, and I saw one of the perennial complaints, which is true. And it was listeners going, Alex, when you've got a guest on and they're saying such important things, shut up. Stop it. But then I think you can't argue with success. Why are we so effective? It's because I am bouncing off the walls. I legitimately am concerned. It's not even hysterical. I'm just jumping up and down saying, hey, look, you know, the house is burning. Let's put it out. And I get so excited when you're saying things I know are true and I can connect it to other things where the elite have written they're doing this to us. It's like, how do I sit here calmly when the Rockefellers did get the Zika? They did weaponize it. Bill and Melinda Gates are involved in releasing the mosquitoes to supposedly counter it, and now it's exploding. And it does target reproduction, and it does basically sterilize you. And then you, there's all these writings where they're obsessed with it. And he took over the Cold Springs Harbor laboratory, and the IBM head set up the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute. Then the United States set up the Nazis with the English, folks. And it's not a Nazi conspiracy. It's that I've read 500 books on the Nazis. I've read thousands of other history books. I used to read books every day. Nowadays, I just read news. I'll be frank. Now I've read something that's science fiction to get my head out of this. I am a total expert on all this, okay? I sit here in Proviso. Oh, don't listen to me. Consult your jackass physician that's, you know, bought and paid for by the New World Order. I'm telling you, the elite are obsessed with this information. Okay, and I want to share it. I don't want to sit there knowing what the globalists are up to and then just hold it back and use it in business and life. I've had so many people say to me, well, Alex, you're scared how dumbed down the public is and how ignorant. That's great. That's why we're, you know, dominating and so successful. I've had folks in business tell me this because they're so dumb. And I'm like, do you understand that we'll be sucked into that, we'll be dumbed down, we'll be hurt by that, what comes around goes around? There is this attitude that permeates society, even in the middle class, of loving the fact that the general public are a bunch of TV head idiots. I don't take pleasure in that. I don't take pleasure in the decline of humanity by every metric, from IQ to life expectancy, despite all the technology, to infant mortality, to cancers exploding, to obesity, to every single thing you look at. We are going to hell in a handbasket. And a lot of it is the modern industrial world makes us lazy. They've dug up people, like I said last night, pull up articles from 5,000 years ago, and they were twice as strong as we are. 20,000 years ago, three times stronger. I mean, the average person from anywhere in the world would beat up Mike Tyson. That's what's so crazy about this is we're falling apart, and these guys are greasing the skids like little devils, reveling in the fall of humanity because they're the biggest, you know, piece of crap up on the top of the pile. I don't want to rule a dung heap, okay? I want to be with humanity genetically, with my progeny and your progeny together to the stars. That's enlightenment. That's the great, you know, human development. There it is. How modern humans have become weaklings compared with our ancient ancestors who could outrun and outlive today's top athletes. An average person, 7,300 years ago, and they've gone through the bones, they've looked at the DNA, they've looked at all of it. We are falling apart. And by the way, I'm not on some high horse here saying this, okay? I'm not on some, see, my memory's not photographic anymore. I said 5,000 years ago, it was 5,000 BC, so 7,000. This is just unbelievable, ladies and gentlemen. And we are, so that's why. Yes, it's a problem. I'm so obnoxious. I'm aware of it. Sometimes I can't stand myself, and I'm on YouTube or a podcast skipping past myself. I get it. But we bring you all these other great guests. I could just be an egomaniac like other hosts and them for 3 hours. The point is it doesn't matter. I'm doing the best I can. Attacking the globals like a kamikaze isn't going to be a pretty sight. So let's just establish that I'm not up here trying to conduct a perfect, polished broadcast. I'm up here throwing everything I got at these people, intellectually, spiritually, emotionally, and that's why we do this. But if you watch other shows, I think the method to the madness is this, and it's not conscious. You watch other popular talk shows, they're interrupting every 20 seconds on average. It's back and forth, it's this and that, but they get people on the panels that are good at it. I do it kind of like the McLaughlin Group guy that died last week. Where he's like, hold on, next question. Well, he's even worse than me. But the point is, I'm aware of it. It is what it is. We're not holding it up as this perfect silver platter. We're holding it out as legitimate humans trying to defend against dehumanization. Please continue.
Well, thanks for saying that. But no, you were going to say something about the smoke from the 9/11.
Absolutely. Thanks for reminding me. That is another problem with the show. I bounce around like a ping pong because it's not scripted. You brought up diagnosis of 9/11 linked cancers have tripled in less than 3 years. Now, let's go back to what happened. I was hosting 6 hours of radio a day at that time. This is not my opinion. And I say that because so many times people think I'm up here just saying something, okay? When I'm not just up here saying something. I lived it, you lived it, but I remember it because I was focused on it 10 hours a day, 6 hours a day on air. They came out, the detectors hit, and it said it was deadly and it wasn't safe. The EPA said, do not go in the area. Christina Todd Whitman, the former governor, said, don't. There was a backlash. One day later, she went to the pile without a mask, reportedly only for like 5 minutes, and then got out of there and said, it's safe. There's no problem. We're going to play that clip in a moment. Now, it came out in lawsuits, and this is in the New York Post and other publications, that they knew, not this article, but previous ones, they knew that it was deadly. No kidding, they knew a bunch of buildings totally collapsing was deadly. And they covered it up to lie to the public. This is just one more example of how evil these globalists are. Let's play that clip of Christina Todd Whitman.
As they say, you know asbestos was in there, is in those buildings, lead is in those buildings. There are the VOCs. However, the concentrations are such that they don't pose a health hazard. We're going to make sure everybody's safe.
Now, that was her walk back the day after. She walked it back even more in clips I saw and said it's totally safe. But they knew, and they didn't even say ship breathing apparatus to everybody, even though they could have got it there in a day, because they wanted to keep everything open, including schools nearby.
Well, that's like Obama and everybody after Fukushima said, it's safe, the radiation's not going to spread anywhere, and now you have thousands, hundreds of thousands of people being affected from radiation damage. Did you hear about the radiation explosion that just happened in New Mexico?
I did. It didn't get much press.
Yeah, it didn't get hardly any press at all. So,
man, when you're out in New Mexico, there's like all these 18-wheelers driving around that have these giant containers that, say radioactive on them. It's creepy.
That is creepy. I mean, that's like the silent killer out there, the radiation. But, I mean, the thing is...
Oh, next you're going to say radiation exists? That's a conspiracy. It doesn't even exist.
We haven't seen the full effects. I mean, just like after 9/11, I mean, I was telling people, any disaster that, whether it's a flood, whether it's some sort of a false flag attack or bombing, whatever, you're going to have toxic elements in the air. And all of those things are just a sign that your self-healing mechanism might be suppressed and you need to cleanse.
They've got studies that I've seen. People can pull this up. Again, I'm going from memory, but you notice it'll be pretty much dead on. That you live, I think, something like 7 years less if you live in London more than 20 years. I'm going from, it's like on NPR like over a decade ago, but actually went and covered on my show and looked up the study. So I'm going from memory. But if you live in a major polluted city, like London was one example, you live close to a decade less. I mean, that's just the particulate in the air.
Yeah, we have, and not to mention the water and the tap water. I mean,
but don't filter your conspiracy theory.
The air and the water are probably, I would say they are the two most toxic things. I mean, you would think that if we just had the earth and the way that God made everything was pure, clean air with nothing but oxygen, or at least 28% oxygen. Now we have 6 to 8% oxygen, and we have millions of chemicals and toxins in the air. And the water, that you could just go to a stream and drink the pure, clean water. That's why we had so many in the Roman ages and dating back in history. They would just go to different places and drink the mineral water. The water in the air was their medicine. They could breathe clean air by the oceans and breathe that salt in, and they could drink clean water.
Oh, have you heard in Europe they're going to start taxes if you have a view or live by the ocean? So now there's a beauty tax.
No, I didn't hear about that, but I did hear that Italy is going to take your kids away from you if you are a vegetarian or a vegan. Did you hear about that?
I did see that. Well, I mean, take Spaceballs. You know, they've got a tax on air or whatever. And he's, caught. Yeah. Okay. China actually has that now, cans of air. But no, seriously, I've got it here in the stack. I've got to show it. People won't believe me. Here it is. Daylight robbery. Tax in Portugal on property with a view. RT. Portugal going under due to massive government debt. So if you have a house with a view, you're going to have a tax on top of the tax.
Yeah, I mean, it's not getting any better, that's for sure.
You cannot make this stuff up. Bottom line, folks, get BioTrue Selenium, available at InfoWarsLife.com exclusively. This is the very best formula of naturally occurring selenium that Dr. Group could develop with us, and it is the best out there from our research. Absolutely amazing. And just the amount of energy and things, again, just added to all this that I get with the X2, with the Super Male, all of this works synergistically together, and your purchase funds the operation. 360 win. InfoWarsStore.com. InfoWarsLife.com is the subsection, and you can go right to the nutraceuticals, right to the supplements there. And again, X2 synergistically goes with this. We're going to do one more segment and then bring in John Ronson for an hour. But when we come back, I know you've got other news you want to get to, other stories. In fact, give us a preview.
Well, this is we've been talking about all the underground research that's been happening, and this is genetic transhumanism with the chimeras and the non-human hybrids that are taking place. And the National Institutes of Health actually just came out and publicized a oversee research comment section, but they did it in an area that's hidden, and we'll talk about that when we come back.
But we're kooks for being right about it 20 years ago. By the way, as we upscale the factories and development systems with Dr. Group, who supplies more than half of the nutraceuticals that we produce, he also advises us and helps us on the others. We use some of the biggest organic labs in the country. We're going to things like glass bottles. We're going to like more capsules. Of course, they're powder capsules, so you have better absorption. This BioTrue Selenium, by the way, is $19.95. They have little cheap plastic bottles with dosages about half of that for the same price at major health food stores. So I'm telling you, you get more, you pay less, you get premium. That is my philosophy. And that's how we do things. And you were making a point about how I'm always getting excited and cutting in. You were discussing that during the break, and you were going to expand on that before you hit one more story.
Yeah, and I was just saying, just because you get excited and you, it's not that you're trying to interrupt, but it's other factors. Like, so if I'm talking about iodine or something like that, and then, you know, people a lot of times don't know the full history of what's going on. So the way your brain works is just going a million miles an hour, and you're thinking all the way back to the fluoride in the water in Germany and everything else.
And it's totally true. We got to warn them. If they just knew what we knew, it'd be game over. Exactly.
So it's a history. It's kind of like a history lesson.
Exactly. And I can't stand just, it's impossible, though, with the spoken word to do that. That's why it's so frustrating. I want to tell them everything, and I can't do it.
And you're limited on the amount of time that you have.
So how do you deal with that? Because I know you're smarter than I am, and you get excited sometimes when we're behind the scenes talking. You control yourself on air. You're an old Army guy, combat guy. But I guess you've learned to just control yourself and ease back and be calm, because you look a lot younger than how old you actually are, Dr. Grib. This stress, I feel physically good, but I look older than I am. I mean, it really gets to me.
I tell you, one of my secrets is meditation. It really helps me out a lot. I mean, I've had the FDA in my office for 3 days now. I mean, you know, we get attacked for what we're doing, but my, you know, our quality control is so important, because when you look at, about a month ago, I was looking online and looking at other nutraceutical companies out there and saying, is there anybody out there that's doing this that cares enough to really spend so much time tracking down raw materials? And it's not easy these days.
This is not a pitch.
Of all the contamination.
The third party vitamin supplement sites that are the most prestigious, we're like the most popular, because we really, people can't believe that our experts, how good this stuff is. And it does freak me out that there's some other good people out there. Longevity's great, a lot of the great, but the fact that there's so few really top-rate companies really giving people good quality for reasonable prices. I mean, it is amazing to again, just know that we're really the best. I mean, InfoWars is now in the top 100 sites, and they even miscounted us as other websites and companies I have, and, you know, Free Speech Systems is bigger than InfoWars. Well, no, if you combine us, the only thing bigger than us is Drudge. I mean, it's crazy.
The good thing about that is, and I love to do this, is just go online and look at all the results. Because nothing that we do matters unless it actually affects the individual that's buying the product, that's taking the product, that's listening to the show. How are you going to change their life for the better? That's the question that I ask myself every day. And you ask yourself, What am I going to do? Well, you.
I don't want my kids to be deficient in things and then have a horrible life. I mean, that, and I don't want your kids to either. And again, I'm not saying I'm a hero, but it's like when I saw the lady choking 15 years ago and or 13 years ago, and no one would help her in a full restaurant. They were all saying 911 like parrots. I went over and saved her. And it's just so weird to me that it's been bred out of us to even care about people. It's like I'm a chump because I care. But I digress getting off into that.
But it is coming back. I mean, we are starting to see more and more people now that are actually caring and helping more people. And that's the
point. But it's not even a big deal. If I'm choking, you better save me. I mean, that's empathy. It's not that I'm even a good guy. It's like, help me. I'm going to help you. I mean, what the hell?
Or, love thy neighbor as thyself, right?
Look, I don't apologize for getting upset because people are in a trance. Look at how they admit chimeras. In fact, I cut you off. Let's spend a minute on this.
I mean,
human-animal hybrids. This is incredible.
This has been going on with DARPA and with underground Blackwater-type organizations for a long time. We've talked about it on the show. It's transhumanism. It's merging animal genes with humans, basically to create hybrids, hybrid humans for military use, for organ generation, for many other things. You know, any geneticist, well, I'm not going to say any geneticist, but if you look at it, the way that we were created, we are not meant to have animal genes spliced into ours. And so for the first time, the National Institute of Health says, what do you think about scientists creating non-human hybrid?
Yeah.
They posted on their website a daily public comment period for 30 days. And this is how they do it before they approve some ability for companies to do these genetic splicing.
You know what? This technology is so huge. Will you tape a segment for the news tonight so you can really spend time on this? Because they're getting ready to, quote, legalize it. It's already been going on. This is so important. Dr. Group, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
John Ronson's coming up. Folks, get BioTrue Selenium. InfoWarsStore.com, $19.95. I was just talking with Dr. Group. He's going to go shoot a video for Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock Central, on how they're coming out, and they've already legalized it, but now they're going to comment period. Oh, you get a comment where they're going to openly start putting on the market the products of the human-animal clones. And most of these clones are only 3, 4, 5, 10% human, like the cows that are part human that create human milk that China's had for 15 years. And they sell in stores in China. The Chinese army, for whatever reason, drinks it. I mean, I've got BBC TV shows about this. 20 years ago, spider goats that are part spider, and they had those 10 years before that. But I've talked to the folks in the research labs where they're not 5% goat or 5% spider, 95% goat. John Ronson's here. He talks about crazy things that go in our world. He's written a lot of best-selling books like Ministeric Goats and Them. And, of course, he writes for The Guardian and a lot of other big publications. He's here, I guess, doing a solo piece, he was telling me. I'm not sure exactly what. But I saw him at the DNC or the RNC and thought it was really interesting. So he came to town and he's hanging out with us today. And this is the guy, if you're a new listener, that snuck into Bohemian Grove with myself and Mike Hansen. Now, the way the media works, though, is one night, it's about 12:30. I start getting phone calls. People are saying, hey, you said you snuck into Bohemian Grove with Mike Hansen. You've taken the credit from John Ronson. Now, John didn't do this. But what happened was, he didn't do it on purpose, but he then, after the book finally came out, the TV show had come out, he was able to admit he'd gone in, but he didn't want to get sued or shut down. He was kind of the mastermind of the whole deal that got us the source inside that helped us get in when everybody else had failed. So that's his credit. I appreciate him bringing me along and financing us doing it. I didn't even have the money to go, plane tickets and stuff at that time in 1999. I mean, I guess I did, but it would still be, hard for us to do that trip. So when you wrote that big article that I saw after the RNC saying, oh, my God, I feel kind of horrible. I've kind of launched the monster Alex Jones. Well, I think you helped me in a big way.
Yeah. I didn't call you a monster. I said I was your Simon Cowell. You were my One Direction.
I know, but I think you did. I mean, I don't have the article in front of me, but you said, I now kind of feel bad.
Well, no bad.
Can we pull the article up? You said something like, now you're having regrets or because it's a horrible, evil Trump creature?
I don't want to. I mean, I don't want my.
I'm not mad at you.
Yeah.
I'm not mad at you. I mean, I'm wanting to understand, though, because I'm really a good guy. I think I'm a good guy.
Oh, sure. I think our night at Bohemian Grove is one of the great nights of my life. I could never feel anything but warmth towards somebody who I shared that adventure.
Sure, and I wasn't stealing the credit. You asked me to keep it secret.
Yeah, and I feel like...
We just didn't coordinate when you finally came out and said that you'd gone in too.
Yes, exactly. At first, I didn't want to say that I went into Bohemian Grove too, because I just wanted to be able to use the, you know, the material. And but eventually, I admitted that I went in as well. There's a whole bunch of people who feel that we were... I don't know if you kind of read all the stuff. I remember after it happened... There was a whole bunch of people who say, well, they let them in. They let them in. We were like kind of their shills. Or their-
well, let's be clear that there was someone that worked there that gave us some intel, and we talked to locals, and then we talked to a local lawyer. We're going to stop right there. But no, clearly they are super pissed we got in. They arrested reporters last time I went there with the History Channel
to try to cover it.
And, you know, we can never be given any credit for anything. You didn't write your books. You didn't get them turned into huge movies. You didn't raise your kids. You probably didn't wipe your butt this day. It was, you know, the Queen of England was there to do that, right?
Do you remember when we first met? We first met a year earlier at...
Waco.
Waco.
We didn't really meet, though. That was fake, too.
Right.
Like, we didn't even walk from our cars up to there. It was right, just that right. The government carried us up there. You know, the government has a respirator, actually. I'm like Darth Vader. They breathe for me, too.
Right.
No, I mean, what that is internet trolls who are what you call real conspiracy theorists who are basically like fiction writers, but they claim they're not fiction writers.
Mm-hmm.
And then they discredit people that actually go out and do real research like you and myself.
Mm. Yeah, you actually get on planes and do stuff.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyways, but getting back to that, it was great meeting you there. And yes, I would say Bohemian Grove, we were already on the map, reaching a lot of people, expanding, but that pushes to the next level. So thank you, John Ronson.
Alex, I'm very pleased. As you said, when I met you at the RNC, we're kind of intertwined in history together.
Your destiny lies with me, Skywalker.
It was a great night.
Impressive. So most impressive.
We met a year earlier. I went to Waco with Randy Weaver.
Yes.
And Randy Weaver said, oh my God, it's Alex Jones. He was like really excited to see you there. He was a fan of yours.
He's a great guy.
Yeah, so you were already, you know, known in a circle. But, and you had rebuilt, you'd personally...
Well, again, that's an example of stuff getting away from me. We went out there, and there was only like maybe 8 or 9 Davidians still living there. These were not the cult they'd said. I mean, an evil cult. They were abused people, kind of used by other personalities.
Mm-hmm.
There'd been this big, giant, fat guy, I think, named Rodin. There's Academy Award-winning films, obviously, about it, but who ran a meth lab and weighed like 400 pounds and would run around torturing, you know, the Seventh-day Adventist break-off group that had been out there for 80 years thinking the end of the world was coming. And then David Koresh, Vernon Howell, stood up to them. So even though he was whacked out thinking he was God, because, you know, 80 people out in the middle of nowhere thought he was better than the guy that was there before. The point was they could have arrested him in town at any time. Mm. They decided to have this big, you know, stand up to a cult, start the civil war with Americans there, and it blew up in the government's face. Mm-hmm. But it showed the disconnect of the Clintons and how they thought America would respond to Waco. Yeah. So the truth is the government was doing evil stuff and lying. The Davidians were just really sad cult victims, in my view, but didn't deserve to be surrounded by tanks and murdered.
Right.
And so I was there saying no, and then you're supposed to be talking here, but this is what Alex Jones does. No, but you're actually here to interview me, so I just brought you up here so you're asking the questions. So see their trolls? That's what's happening here on my own show. But I am going to make you talk in a minute. But getting back to this, since we're going down memory lane, they go, we wish we had a place to have our memorial every year for everybody that died, them, the police. They were very sad for the dead, you know, even ATF and FBI people. They were very humble folks, the few survivors. And Clive Doyle and others, very, very sweet, you know, very pious Christian people who've been abused. And so I'm like, yeah, we'll help put a new roof on this little shack you've got that 10 people can, you know, get in. And I'm going to donate $1,000.
Mm-hmm.
And then they told people I donated that or whatever. And then it got away. And my listeners ran up there and just started building this giant thing to say they were sorry to the Davidians, and it just got out of control. So that's what happened.
I remember.
Kind of like us going to Bohemian Grove did. Because remember, I didn't believe there was satanic stuff going on at first, did I?
I mean, my memory of Bohemian Grove is that you said that there was a Moloch that
jumped. No, once I got there, I went with a more extreme view, which I think was, go ahead. No, beforehand, yeah. I was thinking, oh, yeah, Big Al, right. Remember, you go back to Waco. Let's walk through the story, the next 10 minutes.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember.
Okay. You've got the floor, which means I interrupt you every 10 seconds.
Okay, so I went to Waco with Randy Weaver, who obviously was, I'm sure all your listeners know about the Ruby Ridge massacre and so on.
Total setup.
Yeah, I was making a documentary with Randy Weaver's daughter, Rachel, who was just, you know, such a lovely person. I don't know what's happened to her. And so I went with Randy to Waco. And we were all sitting around a campfire. I remember Colonel Bo Greitz was there hammering away and He was the inspiration for Rambo, right? I believe.
He says that, yeah.
Okay. And
he probably is. He's a very interesting fellow.
And then Randy Weaver was like, oh, my God, Alex Jones is here, and said what a fan he was of yours. And then you told me something that I didn't know. I remember my very first conversation, you said that Lon Horiuchi, who was the FBI sniper, who was the guy who killed Randy Weaver's wife, Vicky Weaver, while she was holding a baby in the doorway of their cabin, was the same sniper who was at Waco.
It was amazing. And by the way, my memory is good, but when you said that about Bo, I didn't want to just say it if I hadn't remembered it, so I had to go back and remember it. And indeed, he did go try to find the POWs and MIAs. Uh-huh. And he's not just the inspiration for that part of the Rambo story. It's a composite. He's also the inspiration, just interrupting, to be clear, for, what is it, Uncommon Valor? What's the one with one of my favorite actors, the guy that plays Lex Luthor in the original Superman? What's his name? See, I'm already getting senile. I'm like Hillary now. Oh, he's the guy in Enemy of the State. Yeah, one of my favorite actors.
I know what you mean, and I tell
you. What is his name? Gene Hackman. Absolutely. So, yes, he is the inspiration of many films. Go ahead.
Okay, sure. So I remember meeting you at Waco, and then about a year later, I decided to write this book called Them, which was, you know, if there really is a secret room from which a shadowy cabal secretly rules the world, it's got to be somewhere. And if it's somewhere, you know, maybe I can get in. So I tried to infiltrate the Bilderberg group in Portugal and got chased away by their private security guards. And so, which was terrifying.
And I've noticed over the years, reading your articles in The Guardian and other big papers, you've gotten more towards my views in a lot of way about big shadowy corruption, but I've gotten more towards your views, because when I was 26 years old or whatever it was, when I was talking to Bohemian Grove, I was there in the crowd of the men getting off on it. That was very real. I think you agree to that in your book.
That was real.
But obviously it's a mock human sacrifice. And then I got bullied by the internet. Mm-hmm. And back then I could be bullied. Not now. I mean, I love it. But, you know, you mature that, no, that's a real person. And that's why I said, okay, maybe. Then the press all ran with that. And that's not right to say. No, they're not killing a real person there. Uh-huh. Okay? And most people there aren't devil worshipers. And I don't think they're all out to get people. But there is an occult thing behind it. And overall, you go to Skull and Bones and other secret societies, there is human sacrifice going on. It's been proven. It's come out in police reports. Little kids being abused. But that's at other facilities around the world. And I'm not going to say Bohemian Grove's part of that. But I did say with my crew, it was Joe Biggs and our investigative journalist, Wayne Madsen, that when Scalia died, they all said this looks like Bohemian Grove of Texas. All the weird devil stuff. Turned out it was a Bohemian Grove subgroup meeting. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, well,
I mean, see, so who can make that up?
Right. And my big memory of Bohemian Grove was, in fact, about a year later. I mean, I know we're kind of skipping back and forward, but about a year later, I was giving a talk in Belfast because, sure, you came out with your documentary, Dark Secrets Inside Bohemian Grove, where you did kind of say, well, maybe it was actual human sacrifice. And then I brought up my book, Them, where I said it definitely wasn't actual human sacrifice.
And I think it's fair. You're going on C-SPAN like, you were with this guy. You're saying they're killing people. You didn't really throw me under the bus. You had to kind of say, I don't agree with Alex.
Yeah, I had to say that. But because your interpretation of the ritual was quite far out, I was forced into this kind of weird position where I had to kind of defend the Bush family's proclivity to mock human sacrifice. I'm like, no. Which is a kind of weird. I never thought I'd be in that position.
Well, I mean, at Skull and Bones, they do some really bad stuff. I mean, that is really dark.
I tried to get into Skull and Bones also, but failed.
Well, I want to say, you're a real journalist adventurer. Everything you do, all your books, everything, I mean, it's really riveting stuff because you actually go and do it.
Yeah, I actually give it a shot. I'm not going to sit behind my desk and make stuff up. I'm going to actually, you know.
But going back, since I skipped ahead, because we're going, you know, kind of like choose your adventure, going way back to Waco, do you remember us standing around out there by the side of the building the church, and you're like, no, they really do have a big statue. They really do this mock thing.
Right.
Even then, see how I got even more radicalized. I was more almost mainline, just patriot, you know, Ron Paul, anti-Federal Reserve guy. Don't you remember me going, really? You really think they do it?
I don't remember that. I mean, I'm sure it could.
But then once I got there and the old member going, isn't it you that did say, but Alex is right, they were in religious rapture?
You know, this is where I think me and you really do combine in our memories of that night at Bohemian Grove. They were really into it. They were really into the ceremony that they were doing, this kind of, you know, stupid pageanty, robes and hoods, you know, ye shall burn me once again this night, and all of this kind of kind of
you shall burn me again.
Yeah, and all of that stuff. And they were really...
Bring fire!
Bring fire! And, yeah, I remember one guy came up to us and said, you know, is this your first time here? And I went, yeah, we just came up the drive. And he goes, oh, you're going to love it. Burn him. And kind of everyone was like really into it. And I thought, like, okay, so Alex and Mike, I'm being completely honest. I thought, okay, Alex and Mike are kind of really into this, thinking it's some kind of Moloch type deal. All the Bohemians are really into it too. It's like I'm the only person who thinks this is kind of nuts.
And, well, the men were in religious rapture as I stood there with over 1,000, you know, billionaires and globalists and world leaders. And they were, you know, I've gone to Holy Roller churches, I've been to Baptist churches, so I've seen it was more religious ecstasy than the lady in the front row at the Pentecostal church, and they were seething. And it is a ritual mixed with Druidic, Faustian, Babylonian, Tyre. So there is Moloch in it. There's a bunch of aspects. It's a cosmology. It's kind of an integrated system to put all of their cares and their sins on this effigy of a child. It is small, about like a 10-year-old kid or 8-year-old kid. And then they are transmuting in alchemy. And I've talked to people that are in the occult. They say, no, that's what that is. Mm-hmm. Not Christians, but cultists. They are putting it onto that dummy. And they are in a ritual of a bunch of powerful men. So the ritual is a psychic ritual with powerful men that believe that they're basically druidic priests.
Yeah, they say that what they're doing, when they burn this effigy, they're burning all their troubles in the world, all their responsibilities, so they can enjoy their summer vacation. So that's their interpretation of it. But you're right. So I was in Belfast. I was giving a talk in Belfast. And I was, you know, talking about our infiltration, about getting into Bohemian Grove and everything. And everyone was laughing, and because it's a funny story. And then in the Q&A, somebody said to me, okay, I know what you think of it, and I know what Alex Jones thinks of it, but what are the people who actually do the ritual? What do they think of it? And I said, you're right. They seem to be really into it. And that gave me the idea to write The Minster at Goats, because I thought, okay, I was looking at, you know, belief systems on the fringes. And I thought, well, you know, these people at Bohemian Grove are kind of in positions of power, and they seem to believe all this irrational stuff. So that's...
Well, Stubblebine, he was one of the top army generals, ran special forces, you know, a bunch of different titles. I thought him on. He seems like a pretty rational guy when he's on the show here. He says, John Ronson, that's not accurate. But then I know you have a lot of the witnesses that were in it that say that did go on.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I interviewed General Stubblebine up in upstate New York in a hotel. I interviewed him a couple of times. And yeah, so he was head of Army Intelligence. I know he's a fan of yours and may be watching this right now. He was head of Army Intelligence with 16,000 soldiers under his command. And he got it into his head that, you know, what is the atom mostly made up of? Space. What are we mostly made up of?
Space.
Well, what are we mostly made up of? Atoms.
Yes.
So if you can like merge the spaces, then you can pass through objects.
Sure.
So General, but to me, I mean,
it's like Star Trek being energized, beamed.
I mean, to me, the problem word in all of this is mostly, he said, what is the atom mostly made up of? Is space. There's some other stuff too. Anyway, so he would get up from behind his desk in Arlington, and, you know, try and walk through his wall, but would keep bumping his nose, and even got bruised and was worried.
But they did kill a goat staring at it.
Well, you know what? A goat fell over while being stared at, apparently. But I think if you...
It was a young goat, though. It died.
I don't know if it died. What I know is if you stare at a goat for long enough, it'll eventually fall over, but it could be coincidence. It could be, like, boredom. It could be just, you know... So apparently a goat... We can talk more about the goat staring if you would...
Absolutely. I want to know about whatever new projects you're working on. I guess you're working on them right now. And we'll come back with John Ronson. We'll give out your website, Twitter, any of that type of stuff as well. I'm Alex Jones. Thank you for joining us. There's a lot more coming up. I'll be hosting. I'm going to go ahead. Right now, let's get more into Donald Trump and your view. I mean, I know you're like a mainline liberal is what I'd call you, but you're a good guy. Actually a liberal that can talk. And so many liberals claim they're super intellectual, but then when you actually try to debate them, they have nothing to say. I see myself as a real liberal in the Thomas Jefferson vein. Like, I have lower taxes. I do what I want. As long as I don't hurt you, I have guns. That's liberal. You know, my girls know how to use firearms. That's real feminism. And no man or any other woman is going to abuse them without them fighting back. The average liberal woman I know can't even hardly wipe their nose. And they're taught to be these gibbering victims. The crisis... In fact, you said you wanted to interview me about this piece you're doing. I don't know if you can talk about your own piece here while you're doing the interview. which then the trolls will transmute into me interrupting you in your interview of me here on air, which is what this really is. But I want to hear what you have to say because it's so interesting. So it's kind of a double interview. I'm interviewing you, me, you're interviewing, you know, I'm interviewing me, you're interviewing you. No, but seriously, teleprompter free, folks. Looking at this, you made a really good point on the phone last week when we were talking about the crisis in the mainstream media and why it's imploding, why it's not trusted, why it's not falling apart. Separate conservatives and libertarians and all their problems and Trump. Nobody's perfect. And the horrible Republican establishment. Sure, I get it. But the Democrats really seem to have reached a new nastiness level. Is it arrogance? Is it fatigue? I mean, you really seem to crystallize the hypocrisy.
Yeah, I mean, it's always hard for me to talk about a story while I'm writing it because my thought processes are all muddled and it's only when I'm sort of sitting there for weeks writing about it that I begin to make sense of things. But but when I do stories, I never want to go in with my own preconceptions intact. I want to see the world through the eyes of the people that I'm writing about. And I certainly see double standards. As I said to you on the phone the other day.
Well, that's what's impressive is you're actually, that's why you're so successful. You're actually a real journalist in that I may disagree with your final outcome a little bit or some, but the point is still you actually do get in other people's shoes.
Well, what I was saying to you on the phone, and I'm still trying to figure this out in my head, but so what I'm about to say may be nonsense or it may be valid, I don't know. But what I said to you on the phone the other day is I was thinking about Pat Smith, the woman whose son died in Benghazi, and she was on stage at the RNC and, you know, very upset. And in fact, at one point she yelled out Hillary for prison. And I thought, wow, Alex Jones has made it onto the stage of the Republican National Convention when she shouted that out. Anyway, after Pat Smith's speech the next day, a lot of people on my side of the fence, a lot of people on what you'd call the liberal media or the mainstream media or whatever, were like, look at how the Trump people exploited this grieving woman, having her on stage. People are crazy with grief and you shouldn't be exploiting people like that by having them on stage and making political points. So the following week, the Carns were on at the DNC and nobody said that about the Carns. Nobody said the Democrats are exploiting this family that are crazy with grief. Now, I happen to think that the Carns have every right to be on stage at the DNC. And I also think that Pat Smith has...
Sure, I mean, used to the Democrats would at least not be nasty. That's what I mean. They've gone to a new level, exactly. And looking... Yeah. Go ahead.
But I find that those double standards, you know, when my people do something wrong, I get really interested. I mean, this is the purpose of my book, So You've Been Publicly Shamed, about kind of social media shamings. I'm really interested. Like, I'm not...
Is that why you're into AIDS Skrillex and Carl the Cook?
Well, I don't really know anything about them.
Well, they're trying to shame us, saying, get out of here, you have no right to free speech.
But then you're trying to shame the shamers.
The internet grabbed it. We didn't make the meme.
Right.
I wouldn't actually do that, call somebody AIDS Skrillex and all that.
Okay, sure. Yeah, so I think that's really interesting. And I think, unless, you know, you need to look at those double standards. You need to look at what both sides...
Sure, but I mean, now he is AIDS Skrillex. So see, I'm saying I wouldn't coin AIDS Skrillex, but what do I do when he's now known as Lord AIDS Skrillex, King of the Memes?
Right. Well, you know what? I haven't seen the clips. I haven't...
Maybe we should play some of these later as we descend on the Carl the Cuck. You know what a conservative cuck is?
Really?
You know what cuckolding is?
Oh, cuckolding. That's like
a man has sex with your wife in front of you.
Right. Okay.
We'll be right back. All right. I want to just fast-paced run through a bunch of news with you and bring up other points Sean Ronson wants to get into. We'll get into Ministeric Goats and your new book about trolls. But since you mentioned the trolls, let's get into that now. You know, people can call it trolls being mean to somebody else. I think as long as you're being mean to somebody who's in power, who's corrupt, who's done something to you, or who you disagree with, you know, you're in public life, you should have a thick skin. I know also kids can be mean, things that would go on in junior high before that wouldn't be magnified now are. I don't want to have legislation that curtails hurtful speech. People have libel laws for that because it's going to be used to shut down my speech, and the Democratic Party and over in the EU, Merkel, you know, arresting people. They criticize open borders and floods of Muslim migrants. So I really see it being used. I mean, I haven't read your book. I've read your other books. What does your book get into and what's your view on that?
Well, okay. So my book is basically about the rise of shaming culture and outrage culture, particularly on Twitter. And I tell stories about people who were kind of... Well, I tell one of the stories in the book very, very quickly. It's a woman called Justine Sacker, who just before going to Cape Town was at Heathrow Airport and she tweeted, going to Africa, hope I don't get AIDS, just kidding, I'm white. And then she got on the plane, and while she was asleep on the plane, Twitter took control of her life and just tore it apart. Even though her joke was, she was trying to make a kind of South Park type joke about, you know, mocking her own privilege, but, you know, while she was asleep and unable to defend herself, Twitter destroyed it. Now, it wasn't, you know, I mean, everybody, just Dean's destruction was a destruction that everybody could get behind. So she was destroyed by kind of misogynistic trolls, by hipsters, by social justice people. She was destroyed by everybody. And that's what really interested me.
I was about to say, I think the real battle for the average liberal, fake liberal program zombie is the hipsters joining the troll army against the oppressive trolling and political correctness. So a titan against a titan, a troll against a troll. So I really see this theme now where a lot of liberals are deprogramming because it's so much more fun to actually troll the fake liberals. But I saw what happened to her. Why is South Park anointed to be able to do all this, but other people aren't? And I think that goes back to political correctness in general, hoisted on your own petard.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yes. I mean, one of the terrible things about Justine's, I always talk about Justine because it's one of the most kind of startling stories in my book. There's many, many stories in my book. And I spend time with these people. I wanted to kind of rehumanize them. You know, the purpose of a social media shaming is to kind of objectify and ruin somebody, define them by a fragment of their lives. And the thing about Justine's destruction was that she was asleep on a plane and she didn't even know she was being tried and convicted until after the conviction had happened and she was fired from her job. And, you know, because everybody's scared when Twitter rises up en masse.
Now I get it. She's on an airplane for 8 hours and when she lands,
yeah.
This is a 21st century issue where your 15 minutes of fame is your 15-minute funeral pyre.
Yeah, exactly. So she lands, turns on her phone, and there's a text from somebody that says, you need to phone me right now. You are the worldwide number one trending topic on Twitter.
But see, let me give you a Jedi secret. The key to that is you own it, you jump and ride that tiger, and you love it, and you double down. If Tiger Woods would have doubled down, he'd be the number one playboy in the world. Right. Instead, he groveled and apologized and slithered around and everything and choked up. And
yeah. I agree. I think, you know, but Justine was like,
I mean, his wife was a bad guy beating him with a golf club.
But I wanted to.
I'm sorry to my wife. You beat me with a golf club.
I wanted to write about private individuals who were completely unprepared for something like this. So, you know, people like Justine and Lindsay Stone and the other people I write about, instead of doubling down and, you know, dealing with it in some sort of rational way like a public figure would, broke. I mean, these people became depressed and
exactly. So let's talk about that. How people are being trained to respond to this as victims instead of lavishing it.
Alex Jones really likes Donald Trump, and it is not a one-way relationship. In December, Trump sat down for a 30-minute interview with Jones.
I know now from top people that you actually are for real, and you understand you're in danger, and you understand what you're doing is epic. It's George Washington level.
I just want to finish by saying your reputation's amazing.
Your reputation's amazing.
I will not let you down. You will be very, very impressed, I hope. And I think we'll be speaking a lot. A year into office, you'll be saying, wow, I remember that interview. He said he was going to do it, and he did a great job. You'll be very proud of our country.
Donald Trump, I hope you can help uncripple America. Thank you so much, sir. You will be attacked for coming on, and we know you know that. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Are we about to achieve a historical first in electing the first conspiracy freak president? I mean, is this the pivot we've been talking about? He's not pivoting for presidential. He's pivoting to Alex Jones. He's pivoting to crazy.
It's as if Alex Jones is now the head of the Republican Party, because every conspiracy theory are all coming together and they've created this narrative.
Right. I mean, this is astonishing. You know, I feel like you kind of have seen Alex Jones-ish ideas filtering into the Republican Party for a long time. You've kind of seen them, you know, edging up to him, but the idea that, yes, that he's a kind of authority figure for a major Republican politician talking about what he knows about the world, that's new.
It is surreal to talk about issues here on air and then word for word hear Trump say it 2 days later.
I think he said the other day that it's surreal to hear Donald Trump saying his words.
Validated.
And it's like, yeah, you're right, Alex, I agree with you for once. It's completely surreal.
And it just just shows how dialed in this guy is, and that's why they're so scared of him.
You got Alex Jones, who I've been watching a lot recently. He's like the main conspiracy theorist, probably the most popular in American life right now.
The right-wing smear machine has gotten Alex Jonesified this election cycle. Jones is the conspiracy theorist and creator of the fringe website InfoWars. They are all in on this total conspiracy theory that literally came from InfoWars.
Completely bonkers conspiracy theorist.
You have Trump, who gets all his information from forwarded emails from cat ladies. I'm serious. He gets all of his information off the web. He doesn't do any research.
This is almost internet culture seeping out into the campaign. Where
channeled through the candidate.
Jones has embraced Donald Trump fully, heaping praise on Republican nominee and his team for their apparent acknowledgement of his movement. There's no way the Trump people would have reached out to me a year and a half ago if he wasn't aware of the work, Jones told the New Republic. He's been what you call a closet conspiracy theorist for 50 years. I think he's been a chameleon in the system and how he sees the time to strike.
I've had some short behind-the-scenes conversations with Donald Trump that if the media knew about those, they'd really be freaking out and running around screaming.
These conspiracy theorists had the GOP nominee's ear like they've never had before.
Trump listens to what we say, and then I personally, have talked to him some off air, and he literally is either the biggest manipulator ever or he's for real. He literally listens to what I and others say. It's amazing.
The Trump campaign is helping make sure that these conspiracy theorists get closer and closer to the Republican mainstream.
The fact that the Trump people gave us passes that, literally maybe 100 people had. It was in Newsweek, you name it, Jones, the controversy had the super level passes, the ace of spades. Oh my God, this is it portends how evil Trump is. Absolutely it portends how horrible Trump is to you and your globalist agenda. And it shows how fast we can take this country back once people get it and once we have leadership.
If there used to be 6 degrees of separation for someone like Alex Jones to a party's nominee, there's now one. I mean, there's no middleman, right? Like, it goes right from Alex Jones and it shows up in Donald Trump's mouth.
Donald Trump himself told me that he's seen so many of your supporters and listeners at his rallies. He loves the Hillary for Prison t-shirts and he knows exactly where they came from. So, Alex, I'm certain that he is gratefully for your support.
The airport just behind us,
and yesterday,
a banner, and I believe it says
Hillary for Prison 2016.
Right, that's not for Hillary Kent.
No, I don't think so.
Right.
All right, very good. We just saw.
You read it? There you go.
Good job, Chris Tula. He's right. The camera operator, not the person who came up with the
right, yeah. Banner. He's not that clever.
Conspiracy theorist for Trump. The Republican presumptive nominee's support for an elevation of the lunatic fringe in American life.
The obsessive sort of singular focus of all these different apparatuses from Alex Jones to the Trump campaign and the sort of the Trump folks about spinning that conspiracy theory particularly.
Well, Alex Jones is just going to declare the entire election a false flag anyway, so
yeah.
he's covered no matter who wins.
And he's going to do very well in the Clinton presidency. Everyone's going to be
If Trump gets elected, he's going to be Secretary of Defense.
Well, that's true. He's got nothing but upside.
I've been told that if Trump gets elected, I get to be in charge of the chemtrail research. Mm-hmm. So I'm really excited about that and finding Bigfoot.
You can't dismiss him as just a crackpot because millions of Americans tune into him now on a daily basis and believe what he says.
And that's why Donald Trump came on this show, was to be radical, was to get in the face of the system. I'm up here defending Trump with everything I've got. It's because I know he's for real. He's putting his life on the line. And this is a great opportunity for this country to put serious death blows to the New World Order. Donald Trump, I hope you can help uncripple America. Thank you so much, sir. You will be attacked for coming on, and we know you know that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Alex Jones, he was a nice guy, actually. You like him? Oh, that's good. Alex was an Alex Jones, nice guy.
Oh, they can't stand it. Can you imagine the government agencies listening to my phone?
The gym on the elliptical, and I plugged in my earphones just in time to hear Donald Trump say, Alex Jones, nice guy. And I had such a shock, I nearly fell off my elliptical.
Well, since you're here, and I'm going to share this to you for your piece you're writing, I might as well just share it with everybody. Because Trump doesn't tell me to say a secret. We've talked some on the phone and other things. But I just, you know what? I don't think it's best if I sit there and get into all that. It's very evident he's a patriot. It's evident he's talking about real issues. It's evident he listens to smart people. He admires people that have independently changed things and set up new systems and have been game changers. And I'm not bragging about myself. they say invention, well, they say necessity is the mother of invention. You've been there since pretty much I started. I was just trying to reach people about the globalist. We did innovate some media systems. We did do a lot of things first. But we had a lot of help from fellow patriots like Drudge, DrudgeReport.com, and others. But I remember, I don't pay attention to entertainment. I don't pay attention to hotels, golf, casinos, stuff like that. I don't pay attention to pop media or beauty pageants. So I knew Donald Trump was a successful real estate guy. I'm not really flashy, but I get he's advertising. So I was kind of put off by flash. I didn't dislike Trump, but he wasn't on my radar. Mm. And then over the years, people would say, famous people I'd run into, they'd go, you know about Donald Trump, right? And they're like, I'd be like, what? And they go, well, you're the underground. He's going to be on the top. He's going to be coming out, be running for president. He's with us. And I'd be sitting there talking to a famous person. The first one does that. And then by the sixth or seventh, over a few years, it started like 5 years ago. Mm. And then right before he announced about a year and a half ago, I'm sitting there with a famous person who's in media, and they go, yeah, you know, I did a TV show with Donald Trump. Yeah, you know, he likes your show, and, you know, he's really concerned about things. And you like Donald Trump? And I'm like, a casino guy? I don't know. Doesn't he hang out with the Clintons? And he's like, no, he just does that for business. But let me tell you, Trump was already, he's so slick. This guy must have the energy of 50 people, like had tentacles out checking to see if I liked him or whatever before he even ran. Mm. And he went and spent a month in Scotland just thinking about if he wanted to do it. And the bottom line, I was told this by people that know him before it was in Politico. And Politico did write an accurate article. I think it's like how he did it or why he did it. Because I've been told that stuff years before it even happened. But a few months before he announced, maybe 6 months before, he spent a month not even really working, something he never does, just focusing on should I run for president. And he decided not to do it. That's not in Politico, but the rest of it is. He just said, I just can't. And he said, you know what? I believe people are actually smart, and they're going to get what I'm doing, and they're sick of the mainstream, and they want to be prosperous, and they globalism picks the winners and picks the losers. I believe people want to go against this, and I'm going to run as a populist and do all this and really try to change it, even though I'm going to put everything I've got on my line. It's a huge risk. His company, his name, he's lost hundreds of millions doing this, spent, you know, $80 million of his own money. And he decided to do it and is all in and is now bound to this. You know, like the ring, Sauron's bound to the ring. I'm saying he's Sauron, but like a good Sauron, he's bound to the ring. He's all in. It's all real. It's all happening. It's all going on. And this is epic. This is historic. It's happening. And this guy is fully committed. That's why the power structure and foreign leaders and the Chinese president and the Pope and the Saudis, all these horrible bad actors who sit on top, really evil organizations, are against him because they know, and he's done it, and they're creating this lie that he's behind in all the polls, adding 15% more Hillary Clinton, you know, people to him and stuff. I think even if he loses the election through fraud or reality, he has won by blowing giant holes in the media facade, and that it signifies the collapse of this current paradigm. I mean, Donald Trump killed the New World Order.
If he loses, do you know what he's going to do? Like, is he, for instance, going to start a TV network or something?
Well, yeah. See, this is what they do. They spin truth. He said 5 years ago, I might be, you know, do a network more libertarian and hardcore than Fox. It's kind of like Fox without the gay bashing. Mm. That's why he hates all the gays, because he was an advocate for him 30 years ago. See, everything's upside down. It's just none of it's true. It's all distortions. They're saying he flip-flopped on immigration. He always said they make it too hard to come here legally. We need good people. We are going to kick the felons out, anybody else that's doing this illegally, or we're going to set it up where you don't get taken out. You go to the office, you get set up, you get checked, boom, you're in. Just like getting a driver's license. If you're not a criminal, if you play by the rules, if you go on a path to citizenship. He gets there making it illegal on purpose. He says all that. Let's skip this network break. He says all that in, thank you. He says all that in these two-hour speeches, but they cut it down to, we got a lot of criminals coming in from here. They're dumping on us. They're getting everything free. He's talking about the freeloaders that come in. Hmm.
I got a question. I was going to ask you this question like off, you know, after we...
Sure.
But I'll ask it now. So you said that Donald Trump doesn't mind you talking about, you know, any kind of, you know, what relationship you have with him.
No, Donald Trump, no, I mean, I've said to Donald Trump before, hey, well, was this an off-the-record conversation? He's like, eh, whatever. But I'm just, the point is, anything I say gets spun and twisted, but I don't think he even cares. But the clear thing is, Trump was already aware that there's election fraud. He talked about it in 2012. He didn't get it from me. If I'm warning him about stuff and saying you ought to go public and he does a day later, it's because he already believes that. I was just there spurring him and giving support to it. And now the UN is coming to oversee our elections. The EU is. The Justice Department's putting 5 times the monitors out. The UN 10 times. That's Reuters. But he's a kook for saying it first. No, he's right. It's a distortion. Look at that's Reuters. See that, John? That's Reuters yesterday, a month after Trump went on this crusade about election fraud, agreeing with him.
Okay.
So there's Obama said he's never heard of election fraud. What's that? I think it's that Trump is a brass knuckles, real Americana, real liberal. And that's why he likes what I talk about and what I say. And obviously has for a long time. But, I mean, it doesn't matter. Who doesn't listen to InfoWars? And it's not a power trip. It's responsibility. I'm just a normal guy fighting these people. I just don't care what the establishment does to me. Most people live in fear. I'm not going to do it, John.
No. So did he... I'm sorry, I'm just asking the kind of questions I was going to ask you afterwards anyway. But I talked to somebody who's in a similar sort of position to you, that runs a big independent TV network like you do. And he said that Trump kind of reached out to him, sort of testing the waters, like... And you said to me just before... he had his tentacles out to see whether what you thought of him and so on. So did he kind of call you before he decided to stand?
No. And again, it isn't about even getting Trump interviews, which we can get. And we're probably going to do one this week or next week. The point is that that's just a symbol of Trump doing what Trump wants to do. Mm. Obviously, with other people in his campaign not liking it. But getting a Trump interview is not the big thing. Covering news... And everyone hearing me for 20 years talk about human-animal hybrids and that are already going on, and now they admit it, that's bigger than Trump coming on. Mm. See, as the Pope comes out and calls for world government, that's bigger than Trump coming on. This is our movement. InfoWars was that Trump rally. Mm. We are the populism. We're just the main... Say there's a NASCAR with a bunch of sponsors on it. We're on the hood. We're on the roof. We're on the tail. We're on the doors. Yeah. There's a few other logos on there, but we are... The NASCAR.
Yeah.
I mean, you understand that?
Yeah,
like,
yeah. Well,
but this has been my mission. Uh-huh. And it's not, it's not about me and the detonator cap, like a detonator cap on a howitzer shell. We're InfoWars. This little officer in Austin is a detonator. And then all we do is detonate the larger charge. And we've already detonated it. Mm. It just takes time for it to incrementally go out and then devastate the globalist.
I think people don't realize. I was at the...
They could blow a big crater here. Just get rid... It wouldn't matter. It's already done.
Yeah.
Like V climbs up in the thing and is happy to die and just lays there and the train rolls on. You understand?
Mm. Yeah.
It's like when he sit there talking to the police state chief and he goes, you and I have a lot in common. I'm not afraid to die. And he goes, the only thing we have in common is in 5 minutes we're both going to be dead. Mm. I don't mean physically dead. I'm saying it's already detonated. The train already left the station.
Right.
The weapon system was already successful. Sorry, go ahead.
Yes, I was at the rally last night, and for people who don't realize, I mean, InfoWars was everywhere. You weren't only there in terms of a kind of physical presence, filming it and handing out bumper stickers and so on, but you were there right embedded in the whole kind of atmosphere of the event with people shouting out Hillary for prison and so on. And it really, I mean, it's amazing to me that Alex, who I... knew 18, 20 years ago, is suddenly somebody who's inextricably linked with the Republican nomination.
But I'm nothing. I'm only one spark that helped start a larger brush fire. My listeners were the actual kindling. They did it. Mm. And again, it's not about a power trip for InfoWars. It's much bigger than that. Listen, all the top generals that aren't traitors are listeners. The foreign world leaders, you name it, John. Trump had got world leaders telling him 5 years ago, do you listen to Alex Jones? Mm. That's where all this comes from with Trump. Trump gets impressed by that, okay? Mm. That's where this stuff comes from. It's like Trump and all this and America and all its staid weirdness and media control is like getting it last. I didn't do all this. I simply clearly saw historically what was happening, read the enemy's own plans, said it, and because almost no one else did it in a modern format, people wrote books and stuff that were incredibly accurate, smarter than me.
Right.
World leaders and serious men and women who were on the inside could resonate because they knew what I was saying was true because they're in there running it. And they feel all alone. They don't want to go along with this plan. You understand? That's the real secret, John, is that InfoWars is really nothing. And it's everything.
But how?
Because it's the people.
Right. But how can you be sure? I mean, you're anti-elitist. You've for 20 years, you've been anti-elitist. They seem pretty elitist to me, too, though.
Who?
Trump or Manafort.
Well, no, I mean, Trump and all them knew that when you sell people to go to your hotel and golf course is to have, you know, gold windows. To them, that was just a marketing thing, as Trump always says, in this system I hate. It's true. He says, I make my ties in Mexico because they cost a third of the price, and you won't buy them when I make them in America. I've done that, too. I go make clothes in America, and I still do it. I go beyond Trump. A shirt made in America is like $10, and then I sell it for $20 or $22. I can do one in Mexico for $2 and sell it for, you know, $10, and then everybody thinks they're getting a good deal, and they buy a bunch. So I say, here's the made in America. Here's the made in Mexico. They choose the made in Mexico. So I get what Trump's saying. It's like, he goes, I want to do away with this system where it's a fairer trade deal so that you can have it made in America and still be successful. The guy is just really on. It's like real. As someone that runs my own company, does my own stuff, a father, I have more life experience now. I look at somebody like Trump who's 70 and I admire him because now only now can I see what he's doing and be able to pick up the sophistication and the stamina. I mean, I don't have the stamina at 42 of that guy. And I've got legendary stamina. That guy is a freaking war machine. I mean, he's awesome. Yeah. He's God sent. There's no doubt.
But you're sure he's not like the people at Bohemian Grove?
Oh, no, no. Look at them. No, absolutely not. And I wouldn't care if he'd gone there. I said, I mean, Clint Eastwood goes there. I love Clint Eastwood. Clint Eastwood's not part of that. It's just some ritual thing. And he's not. As I said earlier, I don't think they're all into it. I know they're not. I've had a lot of people reach out to me that go to Bohemian Grove. And they go, you know, I thought you were full of it in 2000, and then I kind of got deeper into some spinoff groups, got a little bit weird. But, you know, we're not all bad, but I get what you're saying. It's just a cult feeder group. Help, man. It's like going and joining a local motorcycle gang, and then you learn there's actually a meth deal going on, you know, inside of it. You know, you were just joining a motorcycle, you know, club. You didn't know it was a real gang, you know. So I don't just judge everybody. You know, it's like if I've got family in town and one of them is a Buddhist and they go, hey, go to my Buddhist temple with me. And I go and then people see me out in front and start taking pictures. And they go, Alex is a Buddhist, you know. Well, no, I mean, you're not a Luciferian just because you go to Bohemian Grove once. Yeah. I'm not bashing Buddhists. It's just that, you know, it's an allegory.
Speaking of bikers, I met the head of bikers for Trump at the RNC and we had a strange conversation. Can I recount the conversation?
Sure, go ahead.
We've got the time.
We go for 10 hours.
So I said to him, we were both queuing for drinks. He ordered his, I ordered mine.
Thank God.
He ordered a Coors Light. I ordered a sweet iced tea with vodka, which made me feel like much less American than he was.
Sounds tasty.
Yeah, it was good though. And I said, can I interview you? And he said, sure. And I said, so have the mainstream Republicans, like the old establishment Republicans, have they made you feel welcome? And he said, it's up to me to make them feel welcome. I'm more welcome than they are. And then he said to me, enjoy your visit. And I said, thank you. And then later when I got home and I listened to the tape, he didn't say, enjoy your visit. He said, enjoy your visit because of my non-American accent. And I thought, wow, I annoyed him. And I don't really know what that was pretty much the entire
question. Here's the thing. Bikers are good people on average. Mm-hmm. They're throwbacks of like primitive men. I don't mean primitive as in they're weak. All they get is tribalness. They're intellectual, but at the end of the day, they feel like they're under attack. And so they can only identify and trust what looks and acts just like them. And it's beyond racism, whether it's black people or bikers or military or whatever. It's just that rites of passage, they value it so much that it's taken their life over.
I'd wondered whether I'd accidentally kind of offended him by saying, have the establishment Republicans made you feel welcome? Maybe he took that as a slight.
And then he said, I'm making them feel welcome.
Yeah, it's up to me to make
them. Now, I think it was a sophisticated statement from him, I'm guessing, saying, no, we're taking them over, baby.
That's what I thought, too.
Yeah, I think that's what he's saying. And then he thinks you're a smart intellectual. He thinks you're smarter than him. So he wanted to just backhand you a little.
We're on the march.
John Ronson's our guest. We didn't take any calls today, and I apologize for that. I'm told David Knight's going to be in the other studio in a few minutes. I want to bounce some ideas off him. Appreciate him letting me take over the fourth hour. What happened is I used to do 4 hours, and then I have all this other administrative stuff to do and reports to file that I stopped doing it. But our anchors and reporters every day do an hour, and a lot of days I do 15, 20 minutes or a special report, or sometimes I take it over. But it's great to have David Knight back after he was in vacation. And he and his great family that moved down here from the Carolinas. I want to play a few Trump clips, get into some other issues with John Ronson in the time we have here, talk about some Bohemian Grove, other waterfront issues. But the nightly news tonight, something you definitely want to watch. Also, Matt in there every day spends hours before I go on air getting all these incredible clips that I hardly ever play any of. And I've told him, make me play clips. We're going to play a few of those. But David, are you in the other studio? Do we have David in there? Or I guess I just said I'm totally taking over this hour.
I'm here, Alex.
Oh, he's there.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've had a chance to listen to John Ronson. I know you're busy when I walk by back there in your office, you know, watching videos and editing things. But just a crazy world. What do you make of the interview so far? You got any questions, comments, big stories? What do you want to throw into the whole crock pot here?
Well, it's very interesting. And I'd like to get John Ronson's thoughts on what we see with the Clinton Foundation. I think that's the number one story right now. And
I agree.
Corruption
I should have been hammering
that is going
that.
Out there. Yeah.
Chelsea using Nome de Plumes, fake names. Yeah. That brought down the former head of the EPA.
Well, what we're seeing now is the end game of this private server. She had a private server because we knew that she had this corrupt game that she's running in the background.
And the 33,000 emails are all the little crooked deals for billions.
Exactly. You know, the New York Post starts out their article. They say the Democrat Party warns us about mixing big money in politics. They say it'll corrupt democracy. They nominated Hillary Clinton to prove it. Okay. They're always talking about campaign finance reform. So I want to ask John Ronson what he thinks about this, because this is
you know,
the epitome.
David, you're absolutely right. I covered this the first hour, and it's so epic. History, it really is epic. That word's overused, but it's like saying, that's Nazi. Well, sometimes stuff is Nazi, and it's overused, but sometimes it really is used properly. This is so over-the-top incredible that all this corruption's coming out, worse than anything we've ever seen. George Soros running the Muslim Brotherhood, invading us in his Islamic takeover, admitting it's Jerusalem Post having to admit, okay, he's basically a megalomaniac demon. The conspiracy theorists are right. Hillary, just billions, money, scams, total Al Capone garbage, and it's now out there, and our own media is hardly covering it. If it wasn't for Drudge and Breitbart and InfoWars and WorldNet Daily and Daily Caller, and I'm not tooting horns here, it's scary. If it wasn't for us, you'd hardly even see this stuff forced out. But if we hammer something for 2-3 weeks, then it forces the foreign press to pick it up and finally our press. So what about the Hillary situation with the foundation, pay to play, now proven? And then secondarily, as a journalist, what about the media's coverage and handling of it, John Ronson?
I was hoping that you would forget that I was here and the two of you would carry on talking, because I've actually done no research at all on the Clinton Foundation.
Okay, I know you have actually, but
no, I really haven't. I really
smart guy. Well, what was your question before the break then? And I'll go back to David Knight.
Okay. I can't even
remember. We just do this. This is teleprompter free.
We were talking about the Bikers for Trump, and I was trying to kind of dissect what that hostile conversation was, and I agree with you. But
I think he was explaining, hey, baby, we're taking this thing over.
We're taking this thing over, and you come from a world where you think the establishment gets to decide whether blue-collar people get to feel comfortable or not, and I'm here to tell you that the world has changed. So I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah, he's saying, hey, we're making them comfortable.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
And I thought that was very interesting. And it shows this kind of, you know, huge...
I think the guy was really smart. He's saying, we don't give a damn about what you think.
Yeah, I agree. I think it was really smart. It was smart and interesting and layered and nuanced.
And is it that people that tune into Trump, it's not that he's perfect. You're saying, this is an, I'm sorry to use the French, F-U card. It's like, we're done. Yeah, we know you don't want it. Here it is.
Yeah. I mean, he kind of misperceived me as a member of the kind of liberal establishment who was kind of gently, you know.
You're an independent liberal.
Yeah, I really am. I don't consider myself an advocate for the left whatsoever. And one thing that I've become very interested in.
Well, you told me on the phone they've become very bullying. I mean, you see that.
Yeah, sure. I mean, my public shaming book is all about how my people bully. And
well, real liberals are supposed to be about against bullying.
And it's impossible.
And you got a lot of heat for that book I read.
I got a lot of heat for it. We love to talk about abuses of power unless we're the ones abusing our power, and then we hate to talk about it. So that's really what that book was about. And I'm certain that it's, and other people have said this too, but you know, if you want to understand the rise of Trump and if you want to understand Brexit, one thing you really have to understand is the way that my media, the establishment media, is so selective when it comes to writing about injustice, and we won't write about the injustices that are meted against people who are turning to Trump.
Well, let me throw this out about Trump. Mm-hmm. He does like, one criticism I have of him, and I know David has as well, is he likes to just be completely honest. That's a positive thing. But not the fact that he thinks torture is okay if you're a bad ISIS guy. Well, how do we know you're ISIS? That really leads on a dangerous road. Now, torture's ongoing. At least he's honest. So in a way, that's refreshing. But it has a bittersweet taste, obviously. But what if we get in and the communists are burning stuff and people are attacking? Then there's this arrogance of, hey, we're doing the right. Let's crush these people. We have to keep due process. We can't have bullying. We can't have this thing that we're on a crusade or a jihad and start going after bizarre elements of the left. We have to take the real high road. And Trump, if any of his supporters or false flaggers do bad things, he's got to decry it immediately. He's got to be really conciliatory if he gets into office. David Knight, what do you think?
I think so, Alex. You know, you're talking about the blue collar saying that we've taken over the party, and John was just saying that he sees this bullying going on from the left. I see it also going on from the right, Alex. Remember the editorial in National Review that was talking about blue-collar America, where all the jobs had left, and they said, your community isn't worth saving. That's the kind of contempt.
I should do more on that. You're absolutely right. You covered that. I covered it barely. You hammered it for weeks, and your instincts are so on target, David. But you ought to come every day and tell me, just as my boss, for that one piece a day. I'm your boss. No, I'm serious. I think I'm going to create this new thing where everybody's somebody's boss for one project a day or a week or whatever, some quick video. I'm serious. You're my boss once a day, David. You were to come to me with a story that I'm to cover on air or do a five-minute special piece on, because I remember watching you talk about that and say, I should be doing this more. They actually said in a bunch of pieces, you don't matter. It was worse than Obama saying, you bitter clinger Christians, turn in your Bibles. It was the it was like George Will. I did harp on that because I saw you talk about it, because George Will goes, we are the sovereigns of the party. Your votes don't matter. He actually said that. And I did say to George Will, look, I'm not a violent person, but if you think you're so elitist, stick a gun in your head and blow your freaking head off, man. You are a scumbag saying my vote doesn't matter, and you put it in a newspaper, the Washington Post.
Yes.
I mean, I would not wipe my butt with that. And I'm sorry to talk like that, but these people show us how disconnected they are. And see, now you got me frothing at the mouth of the establishment right wing. These are the most conceited, arrogant, know-it-all fops. If they were smart, they wouldn't make statements like that. What the hell? I'm sorry. You just triggered me. David, you're absolutely right. I remember the reading it in the news, in the magazine, saying, you don't count. You're bankrupt. You're scum, white people.
Yeah.
And it's like this thing of like invoking race. They show how they're really the elite getting the commoners to fight with each other. And how they all just hate us, no matter what color we are. And I'm sick of it. I am a populist. I'm a grassroots, blue-collar guy at the end of the day. And I'm sick of all these people telling me I don't matter. When I guarantee you, George Will is an addled retard. I'm sorry.
You and John were at Bohemian Grove. You saw that it wasn't Democrat elitist. It was Democrat and Republican elitist.
Oh, okay? Yeah.
It's the entire establishment. And it's that establishment. It's the hedge fund people. It's the Wall Street banks.
And they get along off with on the progressive the left
that are coming after Donald Trump.
They can hardly hold a conversation.
Yeah. That's right.
They're all a bunch of neurotic OCD jackasses. And I'm not saying you're bad if you have OCD. We all do to a certain extent. I'm sorry, go ahead, John, I'm ranting.
Oh, yeah. No, Bohemian Grove, I'd say, is actually more Republican than Democrat. Bilderberg is
70% Republican.
Yeah.
And that's what we see. We see the establishment, though, across the board, whether it's the media or the government or it's business or it's the progressives, all coming after Donald Trump. That should tell us something. There's an article on New American, Trump versus the establishment. This hasn't been a clear alignment like this since we saw Barry Goldwater.
Well, look, I mean, I am no fan of Trump in any way. I can't
worship him. I'm being sarcastic, man. Go ahead.
I'm no fan of Trump, but at the same time, I'm certainly no fan of Trump. And he does say divisive. I mean, he said some incredibly divisive.
He had to say those to unify nationality because we didn't even have that anymore.
Right. But I'm also no fan of the fact that, you know, something happens to me at the RNC. I need to be balanced because, you know, I am absolutely no fan of Trump and I hope he doesn't win.
Are you jealous of his hair?
However, when I was at the RNC one day...
I'm going to have a meme made of you with Trump hair.
Well, I'll tell you a very quick story about something that happened at the RNC. So somebody said to me, oh my God, did you see the avocado woman? And I was like, no, because she was on really late at night. And I'd gone back to bed by then.
The what woman?
The avocado woman.
The avocado.
Yeah, so I don't know what they were talking about. So then later, and she would go, oh, it was hilarious.
By the way, I'm not making fun of you. I like how you say avocado.
Avocado, I know. God, I'm sounding like...
Say avocado face wash. Suddenly... Available now for a limited time at InfoWarsLife.com. John Ronson's the designer, and a bit of his essence is put into each bottle of avocado luxury line creamery.
For a second, I became my grotesque...
Can you say cream what?
I became your grotesque impersonation of me.
Can you say cream what?
I'm not going to try it.
Go ahead.
Say what? Cream what?
Say Lord Creamlock.
Lord Creamlock.
Sorry, go ahead.
Okay, so... the avocado woman. People go, it was hilarious. You must see the avocado woman on YouTube. It was hilarious.
What did she do?
Well, I thought, God, this is going to be hilarious. So I went on to YouTube. Her name's Kimberlyn Brown. She's an actor. She was in like The Young and the Beautiful or The Old and the Restless or whatever the shows are called, The Young and the Restless. And now she's an avocado farmer. So I was waiting for the hilarity to turn up. There was no hilarity. There was some... Basically, she was giving a talk about how, because of trade deals, which I know nothing about, I don't understand, but because of trade deals, a lot of her avocado farming neighbours have had to destroy their crops, and she was almost in tears on the stage.
And people thought it was funny she was crying about avocados, well, this is her life. Oh, I get it.
Exactly.
No, it's the cold. Well, let's find the trade deals.
Yeah.
Okay, if Chinese electricity is like four times or three times, depending where you're at, cheaper than ours, because of our regulations... Where are our factories going, John?
Yeah.
So if our government is even trying to get rid of what coal we have left, that's, by the way, totally clean now with the scrubbers. Yeah. China's totally dirty. We're gone. You understand? No one's going to have any jobs here in industry. And the average poor person goes, well, I don't own coal. I don't care. I don't own any coal stocks. Hmm. Quite frankly, my family has gas.
Right.
So we should be against oil and coal. But I don't think like that. I know people in my family, nice folks, but they've said, well, I got 20 gas wells. What are you so worried about shutting down coal? I'm going to make more money. But it's going to screw all your neighbors having expensive electricity, dumbass, and we're not going to have a damn country. People don't think like this. Yeah. We cannot compete with China if their power is four times cheaper. David Knight.
Yeah, Alex, and Donald Trump understands it's also currency manipulation that's involved there. They're not trying to reestablish protectionism. What they're trying to do is keep our economy from being managed by a small clique of global elitists
who get filthy rich off controlling it.
So-called trade partnerships in secret and wouldn't even allow our democratically elected representatives to read it to talk about it. That's the issue.
And then it's okay because Obama goes on Jimmy Kimmel and goes, you down with TPP? And Obama goes, you know me.
Well, listen, anyway, my point about telling the avocado lady story...
It's horrible.
...is that we're not going to... You know, this world is not going to get any better until we no longer... You know, the people on the left no longer find struggling people on the right hilarious or just...
That is sick.
And vice versa, too. It's
No, I get it. And I've never been somebody that makes fun of people as much as I have lately, but I got to say, the social justice warriors, because they're bullies... I catch myself then becoming a bully when I'm fighting a bully, and then I catch myself enjoying it a little too much. Yeah. It's one of the few things I have guilt.
Yeah.
So I've never been a bully, but I do catch myself becoming guilty now when I crush someone. I feel like O'Brien in 1984, I'm trampling someone getting off on it. It's a very dangerous nerve.
Very dangerous, and of course, it's, you know, it's tempting, but, you know, but we're going to hell in a handbasket.
It is enjoyable, though.
But it's serious.
But doesn't Carl the Cuck, he deserves it.
You know what? I think this cycle of shame where, you know, what do you do with a shamer? You shame them and everybody shames each other and then people kill themselves. I mean, yeah, people kill themselves over this stuff. And you get Brexit and you get the rise of Trump. You know, you get an increasingly polarized, divisive world. And I think things aren't going to get better until... we start talking to each other. And
I'm going to say this then. I am ready to start dating Trigglypuff.
The Trigglypuff thing. See, that's another one. I thought it was horrible. It's like, look, I have been attacked by social justice people because of my public shaming book. But I think it's appalling to them go and attack them.
But Mike, I got to be honest though. Trigglypuff looks like a 300-pound baby. And even has like a bottle and is then, I mean, this is entertaining.
I mean, you know, I don't think it's entertaining. And in fact, you know, I think.
I'm not trying to be mean, but she's there trying to shut everybody else's speech down. At a certain point, if there's a big, powerful, beautiful oppressor, then it's okay to take them down. But if it's a goblin creature, why, I mean, you know, I get it. My chivalry does look, go, there is a jellyfish. Let's try to heal it. I reach down to help it. It bites me. At a certain point, I just go, fine, school the jellyfish. But if I stare too long into the jellyfish, do I become the jellyfish in a niche type way?
You become the jellyfish. This is my point. I have felt the wrath of people like that, and unfairly, because I defended people like Justin.
No, you said, hey, you shouldn't be abusing people, and they frothed at you.
But, you know, don't, as my new friend Monica Lewinsky says, don't shame the shamers.
I forgot about it. We should have that your final segment, your book's bestseller out this year, talking to Monica Lewinsky, dealing with that. I remember Drudge had a link to your article. I didn't read the book. I read your other two or three books. What is this piece you're doing with me today? I never asked.
You know, I don't know. I became, you know, as I said before, I was at the gym and I suddenly heard Donald Trump praising you. And I thought, that's a topsy-turvy world.
What I like is a lot of what you do turns into big movies and stuff. So
yes, possible.
Here's the deal. All the rest of the media, I won't talk to you. I'm not arrogant. You're just a waste of time. John Ronson is super powerful, so I'm talking to him.
Right. So I just want
to... Skip the network break. Here we go.
So literally, I never know what a story is while I'm in the middle of it, but I just wanted to investigate. It's like, you know...
So is there even a story here?
Oh, I'm sure I'm going to write something, definitely. But I thought, you know, my...
Well, if you don't, I'm going to go bankrupt.
I hope you don't mind.
I've got to have the story, John. This is my big break, John.
I thought my Alex is now a step away from the White House.
Well, I don't have the article you wrote. It was in a bunch of newspapers. What was the title when I was in? It was like...
Well, this is just like when I was in Cleveland, when I was at the RNC, in return for them getting me like accreditation, I promised to write them a few hundred words. So I just wrote a few hundred words about how I was there.
So the Cleveland paper?
Yeah, just in the local paper.
That was crazy. I'm in a restaurant about to leave that morning and... I go, oh, there's John Ronson, like, and on, like, the cover. So you had a link to the deeper.
Oh, really? I didn't realize it.
Well, it had a link. It was a part in the front. Yeah, I went to
okay.
The...
Yeah, so they just wanted me to write something, so I just wrote about just how strange it was for me to be in the arena, the Quicken Loan Arena at the RNC, and somebody is on stage at the RNC quoting you. And I just thought, that's extraordinary. And because I am your Simon Cowell,
But you did say, oh my God, what have I helped create? I feel so guilty. What was the exact quote at the end?
I don't know what I said, but if I
want the headlines, I can pull the article up.
If I did say something like that, it was...
Well, I saw it in the paper and it was different, like, author John Ronson this. When I Googled it, it was a different headline and all online.
That's because The Onion, the AV Club, wrote about the thing that I wrote in the Cleveland paper.
So I saw a different one. I just want to pull up so I can actually show it to you. Yeah, okay, here it is. 2016 RNC, or the week conspiracy theorist Alex Jones went mainstream on the floor of the convention hall. I didn't go mainstream. Reality, a wave of it splashed into the RNC.
Right.
Here, let's scroll down to the bottom right here. And there's this part about, because I want to get the exact quote here.
I hope I didn't say anything too mean.
No, it's like...
That's the Roger Stone.
That's not the article I'm talking about. There was one similar to that. There's different versions. It's where you say...
That you were the monster that I created.
Yeah, like, oh my God, I feel guilty. I've created this monster. Where is it? Let's scroll up. Maybe it's not.
I hope I didn't call you the monster that I
created. By the way, I asked Roger Stone yesterday about that quote where you go, yeah, that young man, you know, hates you or whatever, and he's a Republican, and he goes, get me his name for an IRS audit. You know that was a joke, right?
Yeah. He said, just kidding.
Here. Let's scroll. Well, you didn't put just kidding in the article, Ronson. A little sneaky, no, I said liberal.
Didn't I say he smiled? Can you go down a little? Don't go down. I'm going to go down because I said he smiled. I said, I'm sure.
I believe you.
Smiled. But son smiled.
I believe you.
Yeah.
He goes, I just asked him about it. He said, of course it's a joke. He goes, I don't have time to be doing that. He's not lucky enough to be audited. This week, and I could never have predicted this, Alex's extreme conspiratorial rhetoric is serious, like Hillary should go to prison, is influencing the RNC. Donald Trump publicly declared himself a fan back in December, appearing on the show and telling him your reputation is amazing. I will not let you down. This extraordinary lurch into zealotry has galvanized swaths of the Republican here.
Well,
whilst disturbing many others. On Tuesday, I got talking to a young never-Trump supporter, a delegate, and it goes on from there.
So
it does sound like you're really alarmed. Lord, Alex Jones is having influence. Oh, help me.
It did come as a surprise.
I'm telling you, the Jedi are taking over.
Maybe zealotry wasn't...
Oh, it says, lightest. I didn't want to go alone for two reasons. I was scared.
Yeah, of course I was scared going into Bohemian Grove. My God, I'm not a fearless person.
We're having fun. You know Europe.
Yeah.
You know, I was in a famous world leader's house, not Donald Trump, and... I was just sitting there, and it was a few years ago, and right there and like a little shrine with lights on the bookshelf in their office were three of your books.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So there you go. I know you've had a couple number ones in the New York Times, right?
Top 10. Didn't get all the way to number one.
You're not Jerome Corsi yet. You know, Jerome Corsi's been calling me like five times the last 2 days. And I haven't even called him back. And it's not that I'm even bragging.
Yeah.
I haven't called him back. I'm so busy. It's like it becomes this haze. How do you deal with it? The hundreds of phone calls a day, thousands of emails. I'm just completely...
You know what? I tend to just block it out and just write. Also, my information isn't on the internet, so most people can't get hold of it.
Oh, speaking of that, you write for big publications and stuff. You have best-selling books. You make movies. But where do people follow you on the internet?
My website is johnronson.com. There is no H in John. J-O-N-R-O-N-S-O-N. And then on Twitter...
The ancient spelling. Ancient, archaic, and true. The bona fide. From the ancient oceans, far beyond the Mystian seas.
That's
fame the leader.
A Moloch. And on Twitter, I'm at John Ronson, J-O-N-R-O-N-S-O-N.
At DarthVader.com. Hey, let's bring in David Knight. David, other points, my friend.
Well, you know, Alex, as we're talking about how the establishment is aligned against Trump, I think it's interesting that even the media outlets that have been shamelessly advocating for her just dropped the pretense of objectivity, like the Washington Post. They and USA Today are calling on her to shut down the Clinton Foundation and do it now.
That's right. Don't you sense blood in the water, beyond blood in the water? Yeah. I mean, I'm not just saying this with glee. It's not some personal hatred for Hillary. These people, I just sense that it's over. I mean, even if she coasts into office, have they not delivered a rotting political carcass into Valhalla?
Well, you know, what it shows us is that as the left has constantly talked about the need for campaign finance reform, about how money corrupts politics, and I understand that, that's true. The problem is the power, though. Once you've got the power in Washington, it's going to suck the money in like a black hole. And once you've got somebody like Hillary Clinton, she has the kind of true privilege. So when I talk about white privilege, she has the ultimate privilege, okay?
Elitist, above the law, diplomatic immunity, Marie Antoinette. And if she's allowed to stand and get away with this, it sets a precedent that, mark my words, like a black hole, you just said, will destroy this country and other nations very soon. Hillary Clinton must fall. And Ronson, I sense it. You're hedging your bets. You smell it, the rotting flesh of the Democrats in the wind. Join me. Take my hand. I will complete your training.
But it doesn't make me a Trump supporter.
Good. All right, Knight. Great job. Go ahead, Knight. Sorry.
Well, Alex, it's going to be, I think she is a poster child for what is, we want to talk about her health. I mean, she is the cancer on our country, our body politic, okay? And she is an example about the fact that you cannot achieve honesty here with some kind of campaign finance reform laws. She's going to break the laws. There's no law that is going to tie her down. The laws are there for the little people, and the big guys are just going to break these little spider webs that they erect in the corners to try to stop the rest of us from having free speech.
Spider webs they erect in the corners. Let me tell you, can you feel the energy? I feel liberty rising.
Honest answer?
You think it's more like a fart rising?
My honest answer is I don't. I feel in the middle of July, all of that was happening. You know, Brexit had just happened and Trump was really rising and the polls were narrowing and at the RNC and so on. And then I think he's made some big mistakes since.
I agree, but past Trump, the overall bubbling of liberty awakening, forget liberal conservative, it's just...
Yeah,
the zeitgeist.
Yeah, I see that. I think the fact that InfoWars, for instance, is such a big operation now.
It's just one example.
Yeah, it's just one example.
All right, well, all I can say is John Ronson, thank you so much for spending time with us. David Knight, great job. Nightly News Tonight is going to be jam-packed. 7 o'clock Central, PrisonPlanet.tv. Great job to the crew.